How's everybody doing? Everybody good? Yeah. Did we divide up? Did we sit like at a wedding where the people on this side? The question that's put before us today, this good without God question mark, it's kind of baffling. It's one of the things that when we're talking about possibly having debates, it's picking a subject. And this is a question that to me makes no sense at all. I mean, if you begin with Psalm 14:1, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God, they are corrupt, their works are vile, they can do no good. So there's at least one passage in the Bible that specifically says that because I don't believe in a God, because I actually believe that there are no gods, I can do nothing good. Does anybody actually think that that's true, that I can do no good? You think, okay, cool. There are plenty of people who don't have a God belief, who do good things. Marie Curie, Warren Buffett, you're talking about philanthropists and people doing just generally good things, but we have an atheist helping the homeless group in Austin area. But more important than that, in figuring out, oh, you did something special, I do plenty of things myself that I would just generally consider good, like loving my family and helping other people and working to make the world, at least as far as I can tell, a better place. I'd like to think that the psalmist was engaging in a little hyperbole, kind of like a we rock, you suck type thing, to kind of amp up his own group. But you've got this idea that sticks with people, and in Matthew 7, you've got Jesus talking about how you'll by their fruits will you know them, and a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, bad tree cannot bear good fruit, etc., which kind of reinforces this idea. It's an idea that we know is wrong about fruit trees, and we also know that it's wrong about human beings. We know people of all beliefs can do good, and we know people of all beliefs can do bad. And I would point you to the pedophile priest scandals, amongst other things, to show that people who generally profess a belief, I cannot possibly assess whether or not they are true believers. That's not my job. I don't get to determine who's a true Christian and who isn't. I didn't even get to do it when I was a Christian for 25 years. It's not my job. If there is a God, it's his. And it would be silly of me to try and sort all that out. But this idea that we can't be good without God is one that I almost think doesn't even need to be addressed anymore. But because it's on there today, I wanted to at least make sure that we talked about it a little bit. The question, there's a number of challenges that are often raised to secular moral positions. One of them is that, you know, well, you simply can't be good without God, which I think we can pretty much demonstrate is not true, unless we have some really weird definition of good. And then we move on to things like, well, you're only good because God wrote it in your heart, or you're only good because you are surrounded by morally good Christians who guide you. Those are some of the more common ones. And so my question kind of is Christianity, and you'll forgive my focus on Christianity, I think it's predominant in the room, in the area, there are the broader arguments applied to other religions as well, moral? And my answer is no. Christianity doesn't have within it a moral system. And that baffles people when I say that, but it's true. It has a legal system that addresses subjects of morality. The Euthyphro dilemma raised in ancient times by the Greeks was, is something moral, I'm paraphrasing obviously, is something moral because God commands it, or does God command it because it's moral? If something is moral because God commands it, then morality is nothing other than divine declaration and fiat and can change on a whim. And if God is the author of morality, and whatever he speaks is necessarily moral, then telling you to slaughter someone is necessarily moral. If it's the other way around, that God merely tells you things that are already intrinsically moral, then what use do we have for God? Clearly we can discover things that are intrinsically morally good on our own. We do it all the time. So you don't actually have what I would consider to be a moral system. What you have is a list of laws, or a set of commands that seemingly do not change. There are a number of apologetic responses to this, and I don't know if Mark's going to address any of them or not. But the question is it more accurate, the laws that Christianity has about morality, is it more accurate, is it more moral than those that we can come up with from a secular perspective? And again, the answer is no. If we began with the Bible, as I would think most Christians do, the Bible clearly is not a moral guidebook. You may, whether you think it was you should take it literally, that it was inspired directly by God and everything in there is a moral precept. I think that idea fails as soon as we mentioned slavery. Or if you think it's just the best wisdom of the men of their times who were trying to understand God, I think it still fails because you can't get anything out of it. You have no authority other than the individual interpretation. And it's the reason why you have thousands of denominations within Christianity. Oh, I'm at the stopping point.
Just a couple more sentences.
I will wrap it up then. Second moral systems have an advantage in that they have a way to deal with this problem of conflict. That religion, that's a challenge that religions often say that secular morality can't solve. And in fact, secular morality systems are the only ones that can.
Okay, thank you very much. We will now have a 5-minute opening statement from Mark Allison of the Covenant of Connections Church.
Appreciate you all being here, and thank you, David, y'all, for letting me be here. I hope that's the hardest thing I have to do tonight, is pronounce your name. This is an honor and a privilege, especially being able to talk alongside Matt. I don't know if any of you all have ever seen any of his YouTube videos that are out there. They're interesting. And I was watching the best of, and that's especially good. And there was one, forgive these Christian callers that just get so frustrated and don't know how to articulate what they want to say. And one guy, I correct me if I'm wrong, said something like, I'm going to come over and punch you in the head in Jesus' name. So I figure I'll keep that as my low standard for what I want to achieve tonight. And hope y'all like that. And we'll see. But it's good. So just a little bit about me. I'm very surprised that more people won't come out and discuss Christianity with people that have opposing views. I mean, if Christianity is true, and I believe it is, then it should be able to stand up to that kind of debate. And we'll see if I can articulate those kind of ideas tonight. I think, let me just tell you a little bit about myself in general. I grew up in the Middle East where my parents were missionaries. We were in Jordan for a little while, in a little village out in the desert, and fighting started, and we evacuated to Beirut, which didn't turn out to be a lot better. This was in the early 70s, so they evacuated all the Americans out of Beirut. Ended up growing up on a college campus in North Georgia at Tocoa Falls College, so I almost had no chance other than to end up being a Christian, right? So I was probably born a Christian, just kidding. Can't get there that way. Interestingly, when I got to Tocoa, the first guy I met, his name was David, we're good friends, and David's dad was the head of the Bible and Theology Department, my dad the head of the Missions Department, and David's been an atheist his whole life and still is an atheist, so you can be the son of a Bible theology professor and it still works out that way. David's a great guy, so I know from personal experience that atheists can be good, and we have some good discussions very often. So just want to attach on to what Matt was talking about. When Psalms is talking about the fool and his heart says there's no God, it's saying that within the context of the Israelite culture. And so he's talking to Israelites when he's talking about the difference between people that are foolish and people that are wise, not necessarily categorizing atheists in that kind of light. And as far as Christianity not being a moral system, and it just being a list of laws, my students are, one class of them are going through the Old Testament, and they get through Genesis, and there's some great stories in there. Exodus, good stories too. You get into Leviticus, and you agree with Matt 100%. All it is a list of laws. And I don't know, has anybody here ever tried to read through the Bible in a year before? I've gotten through Deuteronomy like so many times, and it ended there. And did not get past. I got to do one of those other things where you start in the New Testament or something, because there's a bunch of laws. But one of my main ideas about how let me continue on because it gives some context. My master's degree is in anthropology from the University of Georgia. Go Dawgs! And this is a great university here too. You got a part of it, right? So I guess that all works. When God had to deal with a bunch of slaves that had been slaves for 400 years, and he had to get them out of there, out of Egypt, into another land that was full of atheists. No, I'm just kidding. They were actually theists, and that's where some of the names for God actually even came from. El and so forth is a Canaanite name. So he's trying to get these people that had been atheists, that had been in Egypt for 400 years, didn't know anything about God except for what Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had told them. And so he's trying to teach them what it means to be holy and moral people. And so these laws were given in order to do that. And that's all I have time to talk about. So.
Okay, now we will start with some prearranged questions. And these questions were generated by students. They don't necessarily reflect the beliefs of the students for Secular Alliance, the BFI Club, SBS, or any of the other sponsoring organizations. What will happen is we will first ask the question. I will ask one gentleman alternating between who will go first and second. After a question is posed, each person will have 3 minutes to give an answer, and then we'll go on to 7 questions. After that period, we will have a period of open mic where anybody can direct any question to any individual. And the first question is going to go to Mark Allison. He'll have 3 minutes, and then Matt Dillahunty will have 3 minutes to respond. And here's the first question. Again, it's not mine. It's just was developed by students, as are the other 6 questions. So the first question is, Merriam-Webster defines good as a favorable character or tendency. Is it possible to be good without God? Why or why not? First, Mark Allison.
Yes, of course, atheists can be good people. They can be better people sometimes than Christians, as is evidenced by the guy that was going to punch Matt in the head in Jesus' name, right? I don't think that's the issue right here. If you you cannot believe in God and you can be a good person, you can recycle, you cannot beat your kids and your wife and your dog. You can do things that we would all consider good. You can do all those things without believing in God. The question, however, is not can you be a good person and believe in God or not believe in God. The question is, can you be a good person without God? And that's entirely different. What you're saying there, the question you're asking is, if there is no God, can you still be good? Can you still have moral categories like good and evil if there is no God that defines those moral categories as good and evil? Does that make sense? All right. So I'm going to read a little bit from William Lane Craig because he articulates this better than I can. If God exists, our values are simply social niceties defined by our culture, something like shaking somebody's hand if we don't believe in absolute moral categories. If God exists, then the objectivity of moral values is secured, but if God does not exist, then morality is completely subjective and non-binding. We might act in precisely the same ways that we do, in fact, act, but in the absence of God, such actions would no longer count as good or evil, since if God doesn't exist, objective moral values don't exist. What precisely are objective moral values? To say that they're objective moral values is to say that something is right or wrong independently of whether anybody believes it to be so. It is to say, for example, that Nazi anti-Semitism was morally wrong, even though the Nazis who carried out the Holocaust thought it was good, and it would still be wrong even if the Nazis had won World War II and succeeded in exterminating or brainwashing everybody who disagreed with them. It would also mean that the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition were wrong, even though it was done in the name of the Church. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, objective moral values are rooted in God. God's own holy and perfectly good nature supplies its absolute standard against which all actions and decisions are measured. He is by nature loving, generous, just, faithful, kind, and good, and so forth. So on this foundation, we can affirm the objective goodness and rightness of love, generosity, self-sacrifice, inequality, and condemn as objectively evil and wrong things like selfishness, hatred, abuse, discrimination, and oppression.
Okay, and we'll now have up to a 3-minute rebuttal by Matt Dillahunty.
Sure, and I want to thank Mark for quoting William Lane Craig, because I've been trying to debate Craig, but he won't debate anybody who doesn't have a PhD, so it's been avoided. Craig's take on this is just bizarrely wrong. First of all, I'm not a moral relativist, and neither are most of the atheists that I interact with. And if you read, for example, Sam Harris's Moral Landscape, you'll get a good outline of a secular moral system that has that is vehemently in opposition to moral relativism. The idea that cultural ideas dictate morality is simply false and stupid. On that part, Craig's right. On the idea that you cannot have objective morality without a God, Craig is absolutely wrong. When Muslims engage in female genital mutilation, that's a cultural difference, and it's also grossly immoral. And everybody can observe this. Morals are about the interaction between thinking minds. We are the ones that imbue the reality that we experience with value. We are the ones that are engaged in the actions, and we are the ones that interact with others. And so you begin with very simple precepts. The idea that life is generally preferable to death, happiness is generally preferable to sadness, health is preferable to sickness. And you build off of these foundational premises, and you evaluate the actions and the consequences of those actions within the scope of that system. Now, does that mean that there's a single, absolutely correct moral position for any given situation? Not necessarily. It's why one of the reasons why Sam Harris uses the moral landscape, that there are various peaks. But it doesn't mean, the fact that we don't know everything about interacting with others and about societal health doesn't mean we know nothing. And it doesn't mean that there aren't objective right and wrongs. Just as when we talk about health, people may have different opinions about health. But it's objectively true that as a human being, drinking battery acid is bad for you. And it doesn't become good for you just because some other culture thinks that they can do it. And if we find somebody who actually does benefit from drinking battery acid, we have the scientific process to study that and figure out how it is that they're different from us and what we can learn from it and continue on from there. The idea that there is necessarily a God required in order for there to be some sort of objective morals is nonsense. The God required as the essence of and dictator of moral values is nothing but divine command theory, no matter how Craig would like to disguise it. That's all I have to say on that.
Your friend is involved in a healthy, happy marriage, but tells you that occasionally he looks at other women and sometimes even dreams about other women. He asks your opinion on the subject. What is your opinion on this subject? First you, then Mark House.
Sure. First, I don't think his dreams matter at all. I don't know that you can actually be held responsible for the things that you dream, or we'd all be in control.
Thank God.
But the other thing is, you know, this goes back to the way we define ourselves, and we've done a really bad job of falling into patterns about defining humans and human behavior and misunderstanding who we are and thinking we all fit into neat little boxes. We started with, you know, this privilege and predisposition towards, for example, heterosexuality. And then it was, well, maybe you're gay or straight. Well, then maybe you're gay, straight, or bi. And then maybe we discovered that there's this broad spectrum of human sexuality. And we find the same thing in relationships. We find people who are monogamous. We find people who are polyamorous. And there's a broad spectrum of these. And I'm not going to get into, you know, unless I'm asked and we can discuss it, which ones are potentially moral or immoral. But on this particular question, where he's struggling with the idea that he's perhaps fantasizing about other women or seeing them, then my response to him is, have you talked to your wife about this? Because I don't know that, you know, I don't know the nature of your relationship, but not in every relationship is this necessarily a problem. Denying who we are as human creatures and making us seem bad or wrong or born bad or wrong, or that lust is a sin, it seems to me perverse, because I don't know a single marriage, Christian, Muslim, or otherwise, that doesn't survive on a little bit of lust. I mean, it drives the procreation thing. And so, while I don't think it's necessarily healthy, if you're in a monogamous relationship, to spend your time overly engaged in fantasies about other people, it's not always completely unhealthy. And the best thing that he can do is talk to his wife, because open and honest communication is what builds an actual relationship. Keeping things secret is what destroys them. maybe she would be okay with it. Maybe she's not, but until you actually have that conversation and figure out what footing your relationship's on, you can't know.
Okay, thank you very much. And now we'll have a 3-minute response, or up to 3 minutes, by Mark Allison.
I love what Matt said about open and communication with your wife. That's 100% true. Interestingly, you know, on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is redefining some of the Old Testament morality. In the Old Testament, if you committed adultery, it was a sin. Jesus is saying, you've heard it said, interestingly, the person that said it was God, and Moses was the one that gave the command. So Jesus is definitely equating himself with God there, and he's saying, you've heard it said, if you look, if you commit adultery, it's a sin, but I say if you even look at a woman with lust in your heart. I don't think he was talking about your wife, by the way, but another woman besides your wife, then it's a sin. I think, one of the main differences between a materialist and a Christian theist is that we believe that we are more than just a body, just a physical being. You're actually, and it's not even a body with a soul, you're actually a soul that has a body. And so there are a lot of ramifications when you're, that are involved when you're doing something like lust. You're not just affecting your physical body, you're affecting yourself, you're the real true being that you are. It damages our spirit to do something like that, and what damages our spirit damages our relationships, especially with our wives and with God. I've got there's a song here that I have some lyrics to that I thought were interesting and probably appropriate for this time of season, and maybe articulate this idea a little bit better than I could. It's by a folk singer named Alan Levi, and it's called Santa and Victoria. Let me see if I can read it in my next 1 minute that I have left. You guys are going to like this, whether you agree with it or not. So. This year they put Santa in the Montgomery Mall, right next to Victoria's Secret. A line stretched forever of children so small next to Victoria's Secret. A strange contradiction, but somehow not quite, both of them wearing their best red and white, selling the promise of endless delight next to Victoria's Secret. The children were glued to that old, kind old Saint Nick next to Victoria's Secret, while the grown-ups were glued to the curves of Saint Vic next to Victoria's Secret. The kids had their lists for the man in the sleigh, while the mannequins stood there in fine lingerie, both making a promise that neither could pay. That is Victoria's Secret. Now the pleasures they offer are perfectly good, but they can't fill our hearts like we wish that they would. They know how to fool me, Victoria and Nick, to dress up the dream that make it glossy and slick, and I'm all too eager to fall for the trick next to Victoria's Secret. So there's a, from the Christian perspective, all the sex and all the money and all the stuff in the world can't fill the empty void that's in our hearts that only God can fill.
Okay, thank you very much. I will now move on to the next question. We'll start with Mark Allison on this one and then go to Matt Dillahunty. Helping developing nations is a key goal for many secular nonprofits and church groups alike. These groups often find themselves struggling with limited resources. Secular groups spend their resources on teaching people to read, write, understand math, and sustainable living techniques, while churches spend what resources they have on building churches and teaching the Bible. Which type of organization is doing more good for the community and why?
First of all, I don't really agree with the premise of this question, and I got some statistics to back it up. So in 2001, 35% of the total of all U.S. Protestant agencies was spent towards secular relief work. In 2005, that went up to 46% of all their money, and in 2008, it went down a little bit to 44%. So just want to point out that it's not like all the money is going to building churches, and there is certainly in Africa especially a long tradition of secular support by building hospitals, schools. You see that all over, in addition to churches, because as Christians we believe, as I mentioned before, that we're not just body, we're spirit too, and we need to minister to the needs of both of those. I was looking in the Times newspaper, the London Times, and found an article by one of their writers, Matthew Paris, and I want to just share a little bit of that. It's titled, As an Atheist, I Truly Believe Africa Needs God. Just share a little bit of that with you. Before Christmas, I returned after 45 years to the country that as a boy I knew as Nyasa Land. Today it's Malawi, and the Times Christmas Appeal includes a small British charity working there. Pump Aid helps rural communities to install a simple pump, letting people keep their village well sealed and clean, and I went to see this work. It inspired me, renewing my flagging faith in development charities, but traveling in Malawi refreshed another belief too, one that I've been trying to banish all my life, but an observation I've been unable to avoid since my African childhood. It confounds my ideological beliefs, stubbornly refuses to fit my worldview, and has embarrassed my growing belief that there's no God. Now a confirmed atheist, I become convinced of the enormous contribution that Christian evangelism makes in Africa, sharply distinct from the work of secular NGOs, government projects, and international aid efforts. These alone will not do. Education and training alone will not do. In Africa, Christianity changes people's hearts. It brings a spiritual transformation. The rebirth is real, and the change is good. I used to avoid this truth by applauding, as you can, the practical work of mission churches in Africa. It's a pity, I would say, that salvation is part of the package, but Christians, black and white, working in Africa, do heal the sick, do teach people to read and write, and only the severest kind of secularist could see a mission hospital or school and say the world would be better without it. I would allow that if faith was needed to motivate missionaries to help, then fine, but what counted was the help, not the faith. But this doesn't fit the facts. Faith does more than support the missionary. It is also transferred to his flock. This is the effect that matters so immensely, which I cannot help observing. And he goes on to mention how changes in the African people themselves was noticeable, especially around areas where mission influence was the greatest.
Okay, thank you very much. And a 3-minute rejoinder.
I'm glad you found a quote from an atheist. It always bugs me when atheists start talking about spiritual transformations, but I can identify them in the same way that you could identify a Catholic speaking. They're not particularly skeptical or critical thinkers. The claim that not all the money goes to churches, great. And Christians do great things, great works around the world, lots of religions do. The question was, which was better? And if I have $100 to spend on aid, is it better that $100 goes to the people who need it, or that $90 go to the people who need it, and we put 10 towards the church because we believe that people are body and spirit? Well, it's great that you believe that body, actually I won't say it's great because I would prefer that people didn't believe that unless it can be demonstrated to be true. And truth is what I actually care about. Whether or not something's true is the only thing that I really care about when we're talking about intellectual matters like that. That doesn't mean that atheists are Vulcans or robots or don't have thoughts about a poetic human spirit or lifting us as groups and as individuals. But religious groups have had preferential treatment for a very long time, which makes them efficient charities to donate to, or easier to donate to those charities. And they have access to things that other groups don't necessarily have. But you do have secular charity organizations like SHARE and like Foundation Beyond Belief, and these people go out and do work without the baggage. It reminds me, downtown in Austin, on the 6th Street overpass, or just underneath it, every Sunday morning there's a church service that takes place there, and they hand out food to the homeless. And it always struck me as odd that you wanted to hold a sandwich hostage until you could preach to them. And I understand, don't get me wrong, I was a Christian for 25 years, I understand that from the Christian perspective, this is important, this is true. But to outsiders, it's not important and it's not true. And before we should actually allow people to impose that view on them, we should require that people demonstrate that their beliefs are actually true. You have to view it from the outside as we need to be convinced that what you're saying has any value or any meaning because I'm just here to get a sandwich. And so there's an atheist group that goes down there, Atheists Helping the Homeless, that hands out food. The number one question we get asked, what church are you from? We're not from any church. We're just handing it out because you need the food. That's it.
Next question, first to Matt. Dillahunty, a little bit shorter one. What do you think about stem cell research?
I think it's essential. I don't even know that there's really a serious moral question here. I know there seems to be for some people. for me, it's fairly straightforward that opposing stem cell research is flatly immoral. You're costing people's lives and preventing cures because of a collection of cells that, while some people might think that their God has blessed and instilled with a soul, it doesn't even appear in any way to be human outside of DNA. So you've got a collection of cells that, yes, they're living, but in most cases, these stem cells that we're using are cast off from things like in vitro fertilization and stuff. And these things would be going to waste anyway. But my take on this is that if it is in fact immoral, we have to show that. We cannot simply assert it as a matter of religious conviction. We live in a secular country governed by a secular constitution, despite what many apologists will say. God was voted out every time during the Constitutional Congress that there was an attempt to vote him in. We have the First Amendment. We have a plurality, a diverse population with a variety of different views. And you don't get to legislate your particular religious opinions on minority just because you have the power of majority. We don't have a simple majority in the United States. And it comes down to, if you don't like it, don't do it, I guess. But when you start denying people access to medical treatments and cures simply because you have a different view of things that you cannot actually demonstrate, no matter how strongly you believe it, I would say, you've stepped beyond the limits of what you should be allowed to do on the basis of your religion.
Thank you very much. And your rejoinder.
This is a difficult question, and I'm not exactly sure what the answer is. I know what the theistic view is on life. The Bible makes it pretty clear that that even in the womb, you're an actual person. You're not. It's not that you become a person the instant the umbilical cord is cut, but you are a person inside the womb. Exactly when that happens, the Bible isn't necessarily a science book, and so it doesn't really articulate that. But the problem is here that within a theistic Christian worldview, the human soul, the human life, is so valuable that any attempt to kill it yourself, to kill other human lives, is seen as a moral wrong, as a sin. And because of this, Christians also oppose things like euthanasia. Suicide is considered wrong, killing yourself. Even you would think, well, it's myself. Why can't I do what I want to do with myself? Within the Christian perspective, you're created in the image of God. God created you for a purpose, and you are a special thing because you're made in the image of God, and you don't have that right to destroy yourself for something else that also is a human life. And so so in this kind of situation, it's a tough call. But I do just want to present that theistic point of view, that a human life is considered a life even when it's a few cells, from the instant that it's fertilized. In the theistic perspective, that is a human life. And to kill a human life to make another human life more healthy is considered a moral law, a moral wrong within a theistic perspective.
And here's the question. It's a little bit longer this time. Jeffrey Dahmer, known serial killer, drugged, raped, beat, murdered, performed sex acts on dead bodies, dismembered an 8-17-year-old men, yet while in jail claimed to have been saved. Helen Keller, on the other hand, dedicated her life to helping those in need. She was on the front lines of fighting for both women's rights and equal rights for the races. She is a well-known author and fought for the rights of the disabled all the way up till the time that she died. Helen Keller was an atheist. According to Christianity, Jeffrey Dahmer is enjoying the good life in heaven while Helen Keller is in the pit of eternal flame. How can you explain how this is good?
It's totally not fair.
I agree.
Go ahead. No. Let's make this clear. From a naturalist perspective, both those individuals, when they die, when their light switch was flipped off, face no consequences for their actions. All right? So certainly from an atheist perspective, there is no ultimate justice for what either of those individuals did. From a Christian perspective, there's always the chance of redemption and hope, no matter what you've done. I look at God as the God of the crossroads. And whenever you get to a particular point in your life where there's a decision to make, God's there saying, will you follow me, or you want to go your own way? And so we go our own way or whatever. But at the next juncture, next decision point, the next crossroads, God's there again saying, how about now? You can follow me, go with me. So we always have that option for redemption in the Christian worldview. Every Christmas for the past, since my kids were small, we've gone to a friend's house and had Scrooge night, we call it. And we all get together and obviously watch A Christmas Carol. And we all love the story. I mean, Scrooge is an amazing tale of redemption. I always cry every single time. But then I cry about anything my kids tell me. But within the Christian worldview, that's what it's all about, is that opportunity for redemption, no matter what you've done, you get to that point in your life where you tell God, it's like, I'm sorry, forgive me for what I've done, and you accept what Christ has done on the cross for you. And as a result, you can have that that transformed life and eternal life.
Okay, thank you very much. And I now will have rejoin up to 3 minutes.
Sure. There's this challenge against the naturalistic worldview that there's no ultimate consequences. That, and by my worldview, when you're dead, you're dead. And so both of those individuals don't have any ultimate consequences. It's kind of the point. This is the one and only life that I'm going to get, as far as I can tell. Even if it's not, I won't find out till afterwards. But I should live it as if it's the one and only life I get, which means treating people right the first time. And means that we need to work harder to make sure that people are held accountable for their actions here and now. That we don't have this fantasy that, oh, I really should have made up with that before he died, but I'll get to do it again in another life. I don't see that you're going to. But wouldn't you have rather have done it now? Wouldn't you rather have a justice system that actually dispenses actual justice? This idea that there's no permanent, eternal, transcendent consequences for people is a big old red herring. And it's ironic that it can be mentioned while talking about a system that is nothing but a loophole. Mercy is a suspension of justice. It is not justice. It is clear in the Gospels that none of us are deserving of this, that those who get to go to heaven get there by grace. It is a suspension of justice because you all deserve hell. Not only do I think that doctrine is perverse, but it doesn't merit justice. And so to say my system doesn't have any justice, but your system doesn't have any ultimate justice, is nonsense. Because your system has people who, if there were justice, would potentially deserve to burn a lion. That's extreme and silly. Enjoying the good life, and while others who have lived a good life, and who, I don't know why you could just leave them dead in the first place, and there are nihilists and others who discount this idea of literal hell. I don't know which position you have, and I don't want to put words in your mouth. I'm just speaking generally about the subject. If this is the one and only life I get, then it's best that I treat people right the first time, because I might not get a second chance. I could leave out of here and get hit by a bus. And I can't count the number of preachers who said, you could get hit by a bus tonight, are you sure you're right with God? I don't care. If I get hit by a bus tonight, I want to be right with the people that I love, the people who are real, the people who I know exist. So this idea that there's not eternal consequences with a naturalist position is not in any way a negative about naturalism.
All right, and the next question will go to Matt Dillahunty first. You have invited your teenage daughter's boyfriend over for dinner.
No, I haven't.
Maybe she invited him. You walk into the living room to tell them dinner's ready. You find them sitting a little closer to each other than you're comfortable with. Dinner goes well and the boyfriend goes home. What kind of conversation will you have with your daughter that night?
The first conversation, this has to do a little bit, I guess. I don't know that I'll necessarily ever be in this situation. The first conversation, I would have expected my daughter to understand what I wasn't comfortable with in my home. And this would then be a violation of the rules. So we'd have a little conversation to remind her about where the boundaries are. And that if, make sure we're clear and honest and talk to each other. And if she's not understanding what I mean by boundaries, I'll be happy to talk to her boyfriend. The other thing is that there's this idea of personal responsibility is huge in secular moral systems. I spoke a little bit earlier about boundaries and putting people into boxes. The idea that we live in a vacuum is nonsense. Every one of my actions impacts everybody around me. And so teaching your kids honesty, teaching your kids self-respect, teaching your kids about boundaries, teaching your kids about personal responsibility is one of the best things you can do. Now, I just got married 2 weeks ago, so I don't actually, I guess that doesn't follow that I wouldn't have kids. I could have had kids anyway. But I don't actually have kids yet, though I will in the future if everything goes as planned. And I don't know what I'm going to do when it comes to raising kids. I plan to screw it up just like everybody else I've ever met. But I'm going to do my best to screw it up less than some people have perhaps done it. And I would like to think that by the time I had a teenage daughter with a boy over, that maybe this issue wouldn't be around, or that maybe it wouldn't be as big a deal. But I know that whatever kid that I have, I'm going to be able to talk to them. They will be educated on the scientific facts. They will be able to protect themselves. They will understand their responsibility. They will know that they are an independent person who has the right to say no in a heartbeat, no matter what, and that if they are ready and responsible that and willing to take responsibility for the action, that they have the right to say yes. I'm not a tyrant. Granted, there will be certain things I won't allow in the house, because you're comfortable with what you're comfortable with. But I think that a lot of these problems just don't exist. Maybe I'm naive because I don't have kids yet. If you actually raise kids in an honest environment where they are comfortable coming to you with anything.
Thank you very much, and now you're rejoined.
I think I'd like to have Matt come and talk to my kids, at least when they were younger. He sounds good. I think after I showed the boyfriend my gun cabinet, and we had a long talk. Just kidding, it'd be a short talk. And I've got two teenage daughters and one that's just out of the teen years, so I've had some experience with this already, and so if I can give any help.
I might call you later.
I totally agree with Matt. These kind of things should be obviously discussed before boyfriends come over, and hopefully you have an atmosphere that encourages open discussion with your children and these kind of topics. When the boyfriend's there and they're sitting next to each other, it's not the time to start discussing them. Although my best friend David that I mentioned, on his wedding day, his father gave him a book from the 1800s on sex. And on his wedding day, I thought that was a little, I guess it's in time, but it was about a 300-page book, so I had a lot of reading to do before the night came. But sex is a beautiful thing. It was created by God. It's Christian. My wife said Christians should have the best sex in the world, and I blush every time I think of that. But it's true. God made it for a reason, and it's not just procreation, although that's part of it. Again, going back to the Christian belief that we are more than just a body, we are also souls. There's a spiritual aspect to what we do when we have sex together. It's not just the interconnectedness of bodies, it's the interconnectedness of souls. And that's why having premarital sex can be devastating emotionally, because you're ripping apart something that wasn't meant to be ripped apart. And of course, there's other consequences too from that. But certainly having these kind of discussions with your children as they're growing up is the way to do it.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
We're going to do questions from the audience, but I want to make sure everyone knows after this, we're going to the Monkey Barrel on the Gainesville Square. So come and meet us there. I wanted to make sure everyone knew that.
Oh,
I'm sorry. We were supposed to have more microphones, but we only have this one. So stand up and come up here in a single file line if you want to ask questions.
I heard there was extra credit for asking a question, so come get your extra point.
So the Palm 1100 men attending group. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give the first person a question. I will be back in a second or two, but I would like for the questions or statements to be very brief. And I believe the speakers have done a really good job of telling us a lot with a few words. I really commend that. And
You're the first person to accuse me of that ever.
That's a good thing, though. You know, we have a saying in communication, I don't know who said it, but the speech in order to be immortal does not have to be eternal. And I think that you all would appreciate that and have said a lot of good things during the hour. Now, the way we're going to proceed is ask your questions succinctly, and then we're going to just pass the mic to the next person. If you go a little bit too long, I'm going to give you the proverbial hook. So identify yourself as the first speaker, and I'd like everybody, if you're comfortable with it, you can introduce your name as you ask your question. Okay, and we'll go until the president calls it, and we'll just go from there. So here's our first question, and just pass the mic back.
Hello, Mark. My name is Daniel, and you mentioned in response to one of the questions about how you feel that, or the person that you were quoting thinks that Africa needs God.
Mm-hmm.
Something that was interesting that I read about a few months ago is that as a result of some of the evangelical movements in Africa, there was a law in Uganda that would make homosexuality punishable by death. Do you think that that is part of God's effects, that is the kind of effects that God should be having in Africa?
Yeah, that's a good question. And the whole issue of homosexuality is something that the church has handled very, very poorly and not according to God's heart, I would think at all. In the New Testament, you've got the story of the Jewish leaders bringing a woman that was caught in adultery, someone that had broken the moral code, and the people were gathered around her ready to stone her, which was what they were supposed to do. And yet Jesus redefines the moral code. He says, the person that doesn't have any sin, go ahead and cast that first stone. And of course, nobody does, because everybody has sin. And they gradually move away, and Jesus doesn't condemn the woman. As a matter of fact, tradition says that it's that woman that later, before Jesus' crucifixion, washed his feet with her tears and poured really expensive perfume on his feet, showing her affection for him. It's that kind of love that should be the hallmark of a Christian, not the kind of persecution we're talking about there. Early Christians were known by their love. They were called little Christians, means little Christ. As followers of Christ, those are kind of patterns that we should be following. So, yeah. Sure.
Real quick before we get the next question, I want to remind people that there's the donation thing up for an actual charity that's going to benefit. And remind me when we're done, Mark, because I have a follow-up question to you on that, but I don't want to take up everybody's time.
Sure.
Just curiosity.
Yeah.
Okay, my question's for Mark. I have a lot of questions I'd like to ask you, but I'll only ask one. It's simple. I live a finite life. I may not be perfect. I might do wrong now and then. But still, my crime is finite. So how does that justify infinite punishment?
Christianity is all about relationship. It's a relationship with God. That's what if you can capture in a nutshell what the Bible is saying, Isaiah and Jeremiah both say it. It's God saying to us, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you by name, and you are mine. It's all about relationship. All the laws and everything that are in there are all designed to show God's people what it means to be pure and holy, to be able to be in a relationship with him. I'm trying to remember who it was that said that, a lot of people think that, well, if I put things on the scales and my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, I'm good. In God's perspective, though, one good deed automatically, he expects all good deeds because he's a holy God. And one bad deed tips the whole scale forever. You can't do enough good, you can't do any good to take back the expected goodness out of us. And don't get it wrong. I mean, I'm telling you that the Bible is all about God wanting to have a relationship with us. Think about it. God created you. God created you knowing that he was going to die for you. And he loves you that much that he created you anyway. And so his passion for you is immense. And you're not going to hell if you pursue God. God says if you seek me, you'll find me. If you seek me with all your heart. So your story's not over. And so I guess that'd be my answer.
Sure.
Sorry, I just have some fantastic news. Someone in this room is willing to match all the donations up to $500. So. We would love to have more than $1,000, but $1,000 is how much money we need to send the supplies that we've collected to Uganda. If we can get as much money from you guys as we can ship that stuff tomorrow.
Hi, this is for Mark. In the Bible, there are several mentions of things that God has ordained, such as genocide, stoning. You know, you can purchase slaves, you can beat your slaves to death. And I don't think any of us in this room think that those things are by any means okay. So where does that outside morality? It seems that with you and me and everyone here are more moral than the God that has ordained all these things. So where do those outside morals come from?
That's an awesome question. I think my favorite passage in the Old Testament is one that says, if two guys are fighting and one of their wives grabs the, is it wife? Or,
yeah,
you know, grabs
him, and she strikes one of them in his
private parts, then her hand's supposed to be cut off, which probably says more about, you know, the wrath of Jewish women than the wrath of God, but I don't know, maybe that's, I shouldn't say that. But my wife's Italian, and that's that rough for a month. I'm glad you brought up that question. As I was saying before, I wanted to expand on it, and this gives me that opportunity. God's taking a bunch of slaves, people that had been slaves for 400 years, didn't know anything about morality except what they'd heard from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he's got to teach them what morality is. He's got to bring them out of a polytheistic culture into another land filled with polytheists. And to do that, he gives them a code. Now, let me say this first, real quickly, hopefully. I was teaching one time in a computer setting. I taught software stuff. And after the class, one of the guys came up to me and asked me if I was a Christian. And I don't know how he knew, because maybe I didn't cuss that much or something. But so I said, yeah, sure. And he was all excited, because he was a Christian too, just got saved recently. And he said to me, God's been doing this amazing stuff in my life. He said, I used to sleep around all the time, and now I'm just sleeping with my girlfriend. And so if you're a Christian, you're probably going to chuckle. If you're not, then it's like, well, yeah. For a Christian, that's a process of sanctification, and it's God working in us, making us more like Christ, which is the process that all Christians should be engaged in, right? And one of the things I want to point out is that Christians are definitely not necessarily better than atheists, but a Christian should be a better person than he would have been not as a Christian, as he followed the teachings of Christ and proceeds in that direction. So the process of sanctification is going on in this guy's life, which is for a Christian becoming more like Christ. The same thing happens in cultures as well. And so God was taking his people out of this this secular culture, bringing, and by the way, the people around them were much worse than any of the commands that God gave them. So Assyrians would do things like stake you to the ground and strip the skin off of you and leave you that way. But at the very least, it was a violent time, and judging them by our standards is difficult. But if you judge them by the standards of the day, God was elevating their morality. He was giving protection to women that didn't have protections before, and to slaves. But then you come to the New Testament, new standards are being given that are, so, you know, in the Old Testament, you know, if you had a slave, there was a penalty for hurting them. In the New Testament, you're still allowed to have slaves, but a slave has to be your brother. You treat them like a brother. And if you treat a slave like a brother in a culture where slaves are allowed, that slave's not going to be a slave anymore. And then you advance to our current day, and those ethics have been redefined even more.
This question's for Matt.
Yay!
I was going to be for Mark, but I decided instead of grilling you about
Thanks.
That, I'll get mad.
Right. Let the guy drink it. By the way, is there water for him or something? Because I finished my tea, and I know she's not great at drinking them, so go ahead.
Matt, the answer that we just got sounded similar to the same argument that you brought up at the very beginning about cultures determining what's good and bad. It doesn't seem like any culture would be justified to listen to the voice in your head that tells you to bind up your son and sacrifice him like Abraham was supposed to do. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, actually, there's a number of things in here, you know. There's the kind of standard apologetics answers that we get to these objectionable passages in the Bible, and one of them that Mark offered was that, well, these people were much, much worse than what God actually did to them. Well, who cares? We're talking about God's character, not the character of the people. But when you're talking, the question addressed things like slavery. Well, did slavery used to be morally okay, and then it changed? There's a command to kill the homosexuals, and did that change? I mean, did it used to be moral once upon a time to kill homosexuals? And if it did, then morality has changed, and the idea of a God-driven, unchanging moral system is simply wrong. What tends to happen, what, for example, Ray Comfort has said, is that he doesn't believe everything the Bible's true. So those Jews just got all that stuff wrong, which means that for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, even if you're a 6,000 young earther, or perhaps longer, God didn't seem to care too much about making sure that people didn't know that you shouldn't own another human being as property. And by the way, that's never corrected. There may be admonitions about treating them nicer, but if you go to 2 Peter 2:18, it specifically says, slaves, obey your masters, even the cruel ones. I'm sorry, but the only correct thing you should say to a slave is get out. And if your master is particularly cruel, get out now and take everybody with you. That is not the word of a wise being at all. So this idea that morality somehow changed, I think, is a pitfall to the whole Christian kind of paradigm there. And I don't know if that answered your question because you took off. Yeah, okay.
Questions I'd like to ask you, but I'll only ask one. It's simple. I live a finite life. I may not be perfect. I might just wrong now and then. But still, my crime is finite. So how does that justify infinite punishment?
Christianity is all about relationship. It's a relationship with God. That's what if you can capture in a nutshell what the Bible is saying, Isaiah and Jeremiah both say it, it's God saying to us, I have loved you with an everlasting love, I have called you by name, and you are mine. It's all about relationship. All the laws and everything that are in there are all designed to show God's people what it means to be pure and holy, to be able to be in a relationship with him. I'm trying to remember who it was that said that, a lot of people think that, well, if I put things on the scales and my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, I'm good. In God's perspective, though, you know, one good deed automatically, he expects all good deeds, because he's a holy God, and one bad deed tips the whole scale forever. You can't do enough good. You can't do any good to take back. He expects goodness out of us. And don't get it wrong. I mean, I'm telling you that the Bible is all about God wanting to have a relationship with us. Think about it. God created you, God created you knowing that he was going to die for you. And he loves you that much that he created you anyway. And so his passion for you is immense. And you're not going to hell if you pursue God. God says if you seek me, you'll find him. If you seek me with all your heart. So your story's not over. And so I guess that'd be my answer.
Sure.
Sorry, I just have some fantastic news. Someone in this room is willing to match all the donations up to $500. So. We would love to have more than $1,000, but $1,000 is how much money we need to send the supplies that we've collected to Uganda. If we can get as much money from you guys as we can ship that stuff tomorrow.
Hi, this is from Mark. In the Bible, there are several mentions of things that God has ordained, such as genocide, stoning. You can purchase slaves. You can beat your slaves to death. And I don't think any of us in this room think that those things are by any means okay. So where does that outside morality? It seems that with you and me and everyone here are more moral than the God that has ordained all these things. So where do those outside morals come from?
That's an awesome question. I think my favorite passage in the Old Testament is one that says, if two guys are fighting and one of their wives grabs the, is it wife? Or,
yeah,
you know,
two are struggling and she strikes one of them in his
private parts. Then her hand's supposed to be cut off, which probably says more about the wrath of Jewish women than the wrath of God. But I don't know. Maybe that's, I shouldn't say that. But my wife's Italian. And that's that wrath for a month. I'm glad you brought up that question. What's happened? As I was saying before, I wanted to expand on it, and this gives me that opportunity. God's taking a bunch of slaves, people that had been slaves for 400 years, didn't know anything about morality except what they heard from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he's got to teach them what morality is. He's got to bring them out of a polytheistic culture into another land filled with polytheists, And to do that, he gives them a code. Now, let me say this first, real quickly, hopefully. I was teaching one time in a CompUSA. I taught software stuff. And after the class, one of the guys came up to me and asked me if I was a Christian. And I don't know how he knew, because maybe I didn't cuss that much or something. So I said, yeah, sure. And he was all excited, because he was a Christian too. Just got saved recently. And he said, God's been doing this amazing stuff in my life. He said, I used to sleep around all the time, and now I'm just sleeping with my girlfriend. And so if you're a Christian, you're probably going to chuckle. If you're not, then it's like, well, yeah. But for a Christian, that's a process of sanctification, and it's God working in us, making us more like Christ, which is the process that all Christians should be engaged in, right? And one of the things I want to point out is that Christians are definitely not necessarily better than atheists. But a Christian should be a better person than he would have been not as a Christian, as he follows the teachings of Christ and proceeds in that direction. So the process of sanctification is going on in this guy's life, which is for a Christian becoming more like Christ. The same thing happens in cultures as well. And so God was taking his people out of this this secular culture, and by the way, the people around them were much worse than any of the commands that God gave them. So Assyrians would do things like stake you to the ground and strip the skin off of you and leave you that way. But at the very least, it was a violent time. And judging them by our standards It's difficult, but if you judge them by the standards of the day, God was elevating their morality. He was giving protection to women that didn't have protections before, and to slaves. But then you come to the New Testament, new standards are being given that are, so, you know, in the Old Testament, you know, if you had a slave, there was a penalty for hurting them. In the New Testament, you're still allowed to have slaves, but a slave has to be your brother. You treat them like a brother. And if you treat a slave like a brother in a culture where slaves are allowed, that slave's not going to be a slave anymore. And then you advance to our current day, and those ethics have been redefined even more.
This question's for Matt.
Yay!
I was going to be for Mark, but I decided instead of grilling you about
Thanks.
That, I don't get mad.
Right. Let the guy drink it. By the way, is there water for him or something? Because I finished my tea, and I know she's not great at drinking.
Matt, the answer that we just got sounded similar to the same argument that you brought up at the very beginning about cultures determining what's good and bad. It doesn't seem like any culture would be justified to listen to the voice in your head that tells you to bind up your son and sacrifice him like Abraham was supposed to do. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, actually, there's a number of things in here. You know, there's the kind of standard apologetics answers that we get to these objectionable passages in the Bible, and one of them that Mark offered was that, well, these people were much, much worse than what God actually did to them. Well, who cares? We're talking about God's character, not the character of the people. But when you're talking, the question addressed things like slavery. Well, did slavery used to be morally okay, and then it changed? There's a command to kill the homosexuals, and did that change? I mean, did it used to be moral once upon a time to kill homosexuals? And if it did, then morality has changed, and the idea of a God-driven, unchanging moral system is simply wrong. What tends to happen, for example, Ray Comfort has said, is that he doesn't believe everything the Bible's true, so those Jews just got all that stuff wrong, which means that for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, even if you're 6,000 young earther, or perhaps longer, God didn't seem to care too much about making sure that people didn't know that you shouldn't own another human being as property. And by the way, that's never corrected. There may be admonitions about treating them nicer, but if you go to 2 Peter 2:18, it specifically says, slaves, obey your masters, even the cruel ones. I'm sorry, but the only correct thing you should say to a slave is get out. And if your master is particularly cruel, get out now and take everybody with you. That is not the word of a wise being at all. So this idea that morality somehow changed, I think, is a pitfall to the whole Christian kind of paradigm there. And I don't know if that answered your question because you took off. Yeah, okay. And I had something else I was going to add to that, but I forgot it while I was preaching.
Hi. Firstly, I want to say just thank both of you for coming here and doing this debate. I don't know if you're doing well. But my question was for both of you. So we've kind of talked around this subject, but I was kind of curious, just to pinpoint, either of you think that the driving force behind the morality we have today is primarily based on Christian morals or secular morals?
I'll just go quickly. I think that Friedrich Nietzsche said something like, it's not enough that that God needs to be out of the picture. The shadow of God needs to be out of the picture as well. And I think the shadow of God is still in the picture in Europe and certainly here in the United States. And I think Matt's talked a lot about morality, and it's good. But those kind of morals are the consequences of cultures that have been steeped in Judeo-Christian tradition for 2,000 years, and those kind of things don't dissipate quickly. When they do dissipate, then we'll see the true results of living in it. If they do dissipate, then we'll see the true results of living in a materialist-based society.
Yeah, and actually, I've never agreed with you more on that, except for a couple of good jokes. But the thing is, I think the dirty little secret is Luther changed the way Christianity works by giving people this ability called Paul did. But Luther made it a reality that people could have this personal relationship. It means everybody gets their own interpretation, and nobody's God told me is any more powerful than anybody else's God told me. And I think the dirty little secret is that Christianity and Judaism have been dragged, somewhat kicking and screaming through some rather nasty times, by an enlightenment, by secular progressive ideas and values. It's not like God came down one day and wrote a Bible 2.0, and yes, I know it's not one book. I'm shortening it by making a long explanation. It's not like God came down and gave a Bible 2.0 that said, oh yeah, that stuff about slavery, I don't know who you were talking about, but I didn't say that. Slavery's wrong. Oh yeah, that stuff about women, I don't know who you were talking about, but that wasn't me. There was no correction. This idea of equality and this idea of a secular government that we have in the United States, these are Enlightenment principles that came from primarily seculars. Now, many of them were, you know, deists, which I think are kind of the equivalent of atheists of their day to some degree. But yeah, I think it's secular values that have been pushing this, and I think that perhaps in 1,000 years you might see an Islam that has been moved forward across the board by these same secular progressives, hopefully working alongside modern liberal theists of other beliefs to bring the world to a better place, because I don't have any delusions that we're going to get rid of religion. And by the way, I don't have it as a goal. My goal is truth. If it turns out religion's true, I want to know. That's how I got started in all this in the first place.
Okay, first, thank you for hosting this interview. And my question is, for example, like, drug is really moral to hippie, and then alcohol is really moral to alcoholism, like who has alcoholism. And can you tell me what's your perfect moral world?
Perfect moral world? Well, you know, the Bible articulates what a perfect moral world would be, and that day will come when there's no sickness, disease, evil, slavery, things like that. And I don't think alcohol has anything to do with it. Jesus made it. I wish I could do that. but yeah, the Bible articulates what that perfect world would be. And, it said, according to a theistic worldview, that God created the world. The world fell in the same sin that Adam and Eve fell in, and so the earth itself is warped a little bit, and one day that'll all change. The earth will be renovated, people will be probably living in the same kind of world that Matt hopes we'll all live in one day too.
Yeah, I mean, there may be some slight differences. Twice you talked about God creating the world. Once you mentioned that God created knowing that he would have to die as a sacrifice, etc., and that there is the perfect world coming. And my question is, has always been, if God created the world knowing all this is going to happen, why not create the perfect world at the beginning and skip all of this bloodshed and travesty in the middle? Skip right to the end of the book if you already know it, rather than putting the people through it. It's a really frustratingly difficult question. My utopia, my moral utopia, it doesn't exist. I'm not advocating, I don't think we'll ever get to perfection. I just think perfection should be the goal so that we continue moving forward to getting better. And the reason that I'm a huge proponent of secular humanism and secular value systems is that they have within them the capability to change. They are internally driven. We are the participants. We are the architects. We have a say in this process. And change comes in a secular system by discussion and debate and becoming convinced. And in the religious conflicts from the various religious proposals about morals, change comes from struggle and conversion more than becoming convinced. And there are people certainly who become convinced that their particular religion is true. I don't want to diminish it. But secularism has that as its foundation, that this is the way we should change. The question that I would love to actually maybe sit down at some point and talk to Mark about is, okay, you and I have different worldviews, we have different ideas about morality, we have all these, how do we resolve those? How do the two of us sit down and determine what's actually true? And to the extent that we might not be able to,
how do we sit down and determine what kind of world we're willing to share and maintain our boundaries? That's the kind of question that I'm actually interested in. Is there an answer? I don't know.
Hi. This is, my question's for Matt. In reference to your statement that there is no actual justice in the plan of mercy by God granting us grace and, you know, forgiving us of all of our wrongdoings and sins, I think that's just sort of a comment before my question. I think that's sort of ignoring the idea of, you know, the core of Christianity, which is that Jesus Christ actually came and took that punishment that we deserve. And so I guess my question is, do you believe that the punishment that Christ took for us is in fact just in itself? Because I didn't hear you mention that in your in the comments, that there is no you know, ultimate justice in God's plan. So I guess just my question is, do you believe that Christ, if, you know, of course, speaking or saying that this that Christianity is real and that Jesus did exist and that God does exist, do you believe that it would be hypothetically a just thing to do to punish his own son for the wrongs that we did and then granting us mercy in return?
No. And again, if I take that as a hypothetical, I'll do my best to take it as a hypothetical. The problem is that, and I used to see things that way. I used to see, for example, the story of Abraham and Isaac in a way very different from than I see now, and I may get to that later. But when I look at this, even if I try to take it as a hypothetical, it's so absurd and patently offensive. The idea, first of all, of original sin is immoral. The idea of substitutionary atonement is immoral. If I owe somebody something and somebody else comes along and pays them, yeah, that gets me off the hook. But if I've wronged somebody, which is what we're talking about when we're talking about moral things and not just a $20 bill, saying somebody else telling them that I'm sorry doesn't do a thing. So I'm opposed to the idea of original sin. I'm opposed to the concept of sin entirely, the idea that butts are crimes or that you've wronged some being. I don't know how you can wrong a God. It seems silly to me. But substitutionary atonement is also something that I think is immoral. And the part of it that I find absurd is that you have this all-knowing, all-loving being who creates a system, supposedly or reportedly by some, knowing what's going to happen, and if he's the architect of the rules of this system, I would think, by everything I ever learned. And so you have a God that created a system knowing that he would actually have to take human form and come down and sacrifice himself to serve as a loophole for a rule that he created. It's as absurd as why don't we skip to the end of the book? Why not just forgive him?
Okay, I have a question to both of you. I would like to kind of touch on the subject of Bible, maybe the source of morality. And, you know, when I look at the story of Jewish people leaving Egypt, arriving at the promised land, and they are supposed to live there happily ever after, but there is a problem. Somebody is already living there. And then God gives them direct order to go and kill everybody, including children, women, everybody. Now the question is, when they did, right? They went and they killed everybody. Was this act of killing everybody a moral act, or was this an immoral act? That's kind of a direct question.
I'll go first, it was immoral.
staying with my premise that God was taking a group of people from out of a situation where they didn't know anything about him, bringing them to a place eventually where they would, where we are now. That was a process. So just as you are watching your kids learning how to take their first steps, you don't criticize them because they can't run a marathon. In the same way, as God deals with cultures, he takes the culture from where they are, baby steps, brings them to eventually where they'll be here, and where we abhor things like slavery, and which, by the way, in at least, you know, in England, certainly was spearheaded by Christians.
Yes.
I think this is a question for Mark. Recently, there was a law on the ballot in Mississippi that would have declared personhood at conception and would have effectively outlawed most birth control, like IUDs and the pill. What kind of, you kind of touched on the subject with stem cells, but how do you feel about the idea of life and contraception in relation to birth control and women's rights?
First of all, I'd say that that the Bible has always elevated women above the level of their surrounding culture, whenever that happened to be. Okay. Yes. The Bible's always. I'm not saying that the Bible elevated them above where they are now, but until in regard to what I said with stem cell research, life happens at conception according to the theistic worldview. So you're killing a life if you do that, and that's why we oppose that.
Just.
Actually, go
ahead.
Yeah. On the idea of the Bible elevating women, I wish we'd had a debate on that. Actually, because there's so much, and I think that I'll just use the go-to quickest one, which is if you rape a woman, you have to marry her. Women were property. You had spoiled some other man's property, and your penalty for raping a woman was to marry her and pay 15 shekels a penny. We can adjust for inflation. That, in the same way that I mentioned this problem about Abraham and Isaac, first of all, you don't hear too much about how it felt to be Isaac or what kind of torture it was to be in a position where your father's going to kill you. But sticking with what I'm talking about, there's absolutely no consideration at all of whether or not a woman who's been raped wants to be forced to live and marry the person who raped her. That is an absurd thing that does nothing to elevate women. The idea of, when we talk about potential abortion positions and things, the Bible is relatively silent on abortion. Jeremiah 1:5 is a go-to verse where it says, I knew you before I crafted you in the womb, which to me is a testimony of God talking about, I knew your soul before even any conception occurred, and not anything about in the womb. Jewish law doesn't consider a fetus in the womb to be a person. When the censuses were taken in the Bible, it wasn't until the child had been alive for a month, because infant mortality rates were incredible at the time. And there's a passage about if men are struggling and a woman is forced to miscarry, there's a different penalty for the miscarriage of a child than there is for the intentional killing of the woman. So the fetus isn't considered a person in the Bible in any sense. It's a matter of interpretation that people feel that way about it, because God kind of knew you in the womb, so you must be a person. And I don't see anything that particularly elevates women in Christianity. I just find it baffling that I mean, everything you've said tonight, I've seen where it was coming from, and a lot of it, I put my hat on from back when I was a Southern Baptist. But not that one. I have to save it for whatever.
When are we going out afterwards?
Have you guys ever knew example that I had a conversation as easy as you did? I'm sure everyone
would. Maybe I'll do a Skype nonprofits with Mark at some point. We'll have all the conversations.
Also, on that previous topic, just because you said earlier that the child or fetus or a life was actually once an egg was fertilized, however, contraceptives would only be preventing an egg from being fertilized, not necessarily killing one that was.
Something that doesn't, that stops that process from a physical view wouldn't be a problem. Maybe if you're Catholic.
Yeah.
But not within, certainly within Protestant evangelism.
And to revisit something else you said that lust hurts our self-being. Within the context of a loving, faithful, monogamous relationship, if those two individuals were to watch, say, pornography before sexual intercourse, how would that be degrading to an individual's self?
Because you're a spiritual being as well as a physical being, things that can affect your spirit affect you. And within the Christian worldview, those kind of things do affect you. And it just makes sense. I mean, if you have an idea of what sex should be like from watching pornography, that's going to shift your view of what sex should be. And from a Christian perspective, pornography is wrong, and those kind of shifts are damaging.
I'm really sorry, what necessarily makes watching pornography make it have an effect on you? You don't feel like you can watch it and not be changed and have your own ideas, watch something and still separate your ideals from sex?
Actually, if I could jump in, I agree with it that it has an effect on you. I just don't agree that it's necessarily negative. Why would you watch it?
If nothing else, it has an effect on the people that are engaged in the pornography. And by participating and watching it, you're validating what they're doing. And we feel that that's destructive for them, whether they acknowledge that kind of effect or not. And participating in the hurt of somebody else is not something that Christians could do.
This is another one from Mark. All my Christian friends claim that they are believers because God revealed himself to them in some way. And my question is, if God created us all, why does he choose to reveal himself to some, not to others?
Big clap. Yeah, I think God has revealed himself to all. God speaks through his word. What his Christian view is that the Bible is God's word to us, and it's inspired, which means it's God-breathed, that the Holy Spirit speaks through it, and so he talks to us. So God speaks to anybody that will listen, and that's the worldview. And there's an element, it's called a Christian faith for a reason, because there is an element of faith. There's a lot of an element of faith. It's also grounded in history, and so it's not totally faith, but it's there. But faith is there for a reason. Have you ever played that game where you like fall back and someone's there to catch you?
Trust
fall. What's it called?
Trust fall.
Trust fall, yeah. So, you ever had anybody like miss you and fall? But the idea there is that, you know, there's an element of faith. You're trusting that person that you after you've performed that, you have a concrete faith in them based on experience. And God does the same kind of thing with us. Faith is not there just because God wants to dangle something in front of you that you can't see and then blame you when you can't catch it. Faith is there to strengthen that part of you that is spirit, because God is spirit too, and it enhances that relationship that you have because it's spirit-based.
And if I could, sorry, go ahead. I was going to actually address it fairly quickly. It's called the trust fall. And I actually make a distinction between trust and faith. And trust is something you grant. It's either rewarded or not. And you base your decisions on that based on what you've petered out. Faith, in my definition, is faith is the reason people give for believing, or the excuse. I often say people give for believing something when they don't have good reason. Because if you have a good reason, then you wouldn't make any appeal to faith. I'm a non-believer now, in particular, because I took 1 Peter 3:15 very seriously, which, as far as I was concerned, instructed every Christian to be prepared at all times to give a reason for the faith, which now I see as somewhat contradictory. But the reason there is translated from the Greek logos. So I took it to be a logical reason. Now, that may have been a mistake on my part. But this idea that God will reveal himself to anybody who sincerely seeks is one that I find absolutely frustrating, because I cannot prove it to you or to anybody else, and it wouldn't matter if I could. I am not aware of anybody who more earnestly and honestly sought out God. I was already a believer. I had the feeling that I was running from a call to the ministry, and that I have this time and this opportunity and this money. And so I spent 18 months or so in serious study and prayer. I didn't just memorize Bible verses so I could come here and toss them out today. This was who I was. And if my sincere attempt to communicate with God did not have that result, then that statement seems kind of empty to me and absurd, because I can't imagine anybody who would endeavor to do more than I did at the time. And it's incredibly frustrating, because the number of people who claim these revelations and have absolutely no knowledge about the theology that they have accepted and could not have done an engaging discussion like this tonight is baffling. I grant they may not be telling the truth. I don't know. Like I said, I have no way of telling who's a true Christian, who's not. But the idea that if you ask, God will reveal himself to you is, you'd have to take it on faith that it didn't happen to me. But boy, is that frustrating. Because it makes me out to be a liar and dishonest, and neither of those six.
Okay, the hour is, let's see, it is 8:38. We're going to try to get this done, I think, by 9. So the remaining people will be the only ones off the questions. So we ask these 10 questions to be fairly succinct, as well as the answers. Thank you.
Hey, Matt. Hey, Mark.
Hey.
I have a question that's like, speaking to Eddie Long and all of those ministers and people in religion who do something and do something wrong that's against society. And what if what if Eddie Long basically was praying every night, please, Lord, don't let me, be attracted to young boys, please, 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 and don't let me do anything, and then he does it. And in a sense, he is let down by this God. I mean, he's let down, and how that plays into the church itself, into his followers, and how they are, in a sense, let down by this God. And I'd like for you to speak to that, but real quickly, what that says to me, that's pretty painful to watch people who follow this belief system, and then they're let down like that. And I feel so sad for them because of that. And that kind of speaks to what Matt was saying, one of his atheist experiences that went viral, when you were talking about how emotionally it hurts when you see people wrapped up into this religion, and how painful it is for the non-believer to see people following and they get let down like that. So could both of you speak to that? Thank you.
Yeah, I find it painful to watch evangelists on TV too. My wife usually tells me I'm going to hell for the things I say when I watch them. She might be right.
You'll be a good company, buddy.
Yeah. But it's hard to blame God for what Eddie Long did. None of us are perfect, and the Bible doesn't perfection isn't what gets you into heaven. Being good isn't what gets you in heaven. It's a relationship with God that does that. And again, like I said before, all of Christianity is about relationship with God from beginning to end. And when we fall, he's there to help us pick up the pieces.
And I just say that I think this has nothing to do with the truth of any religion. But religions and religious organizations have done the entire planet a huge disservice by disguising mental issues, mental health issues. They used to do it with appeals to demonic possession, and now they do it by hiding the perpetrators and shuffling them down to different, or shuffling around to different parishes. We've done a lot, thank you. We've done a lot of improvement. I talk about morality being analogous to health. We know quite a bit about human physical health. We're getting a little better about human mental health. If I could put words in Mark's mouth, I think Mark would think that we probably need to get better about human spiritual health. In my case, what I take to be the equivalent of that human spiritual health is it's certainly metaphoric, and it has to do with our interactions with each other.
And we need to wake people up and stop hiding mental illnesses and stop protecting people who are harming other people and get them help. I have no idea whether anything about Eddie Long, whether he was guilty or not. I followed it beyond the initial accusations because I'm frankly bored. It's sad. I'm bored of accusations of pedophiles in the clergy. How can you get bored of that? We should be screaming and yelling. What happened at Penn State, they rioted because Joe Pa got fired. He should have got fired. All of them should have got fired. Somebody, when they came across that man in their raping a boy, should have been fired. I think Penn State is analogous to religion in this way. They had football was their religion. Joe Pa was their pope. And they were going to protect him at all costs, even at the cost of little kids. None of us, it's not, is there anybody in the room that disagrees with that? We are all way better than that. Okay.
Amen.
You can tell me why later.
Okay.
Cool. Next.
Hi, this is a question for both of you. It's a specific moral question. It's a hypothetical. I imagine Marcus has an advantage on this for a couple of reasons. But the example of Abraham and Isaac, the sacrifice Isaac has been alluded to a couple of times. And the question is this. I'd like you to assume for a moment that God exists, that you know he exists, and that he is able to communicate with you in an unambiguous way. And now I don't know, Mark, I don't know your take on some of the Old Testament stories. I know there are some traditions that consider them more important for their allegorical value than their literal historicity. But there are some rabbinical traditions that actually debate whether or not Abraham failed or passed the test.
He failed.
And so my question for you is, assume there is a God, assume he has communicated with you this command, what is your moral duty to do in the situation with Abraham?
Yeah, it's really quick and easy for me, and that's my view on this change, not only about why Isaac's torment was ignored, but people often claim that the biblical God doesn't sanction human sacrifice, Jephthah notwithstanding, and that's a separate debate as to whether or not there was or wasn't a sacrifice there. The idea is, I'm Abraham, and I know God exists, and God's going to talk to me, and he commands me to kill my son, and my God is a loving God. The one and only correct answer is, I don't know who you are, but my God would never do this, and there's no way I'm killing my son, go away. And by the way, where is my God to protect me from a monster like you? That's the one and only correct answer. It wasn't a test. This idea that it was a test, God wasn't testing Abraham so God could figure out what Abraham would do. God already knew. The typical thing is God was testing Abraham so Abraham knew what he would do. And he failed, in my opinion. And it existed.
I totally disagree. Abraham was coming out of a culture that did engage in human sacrifice. Whatever you believe about Jephthah, by the way, the Bible doesn't condone what he did. And God knew that he was never going to sacrifice Isaac. And what God was, one of the many pictures that was happening there, besides as being a picture of what Christ would actually do himself, which was become the sacrifice for all of us, so that we could have that relationship with him. Isaac was never going to be killed. But God wanted to let us see a picture of how intense his passion is for us, that he himself would be the one to place himself on that altar instead of Isaac eventually, so that we could all have that relationship with him.
And can I?
Yeah, go.
To me, the lesson from that story, when you put it that way, is one of blind obedience, which may be true about the God of the Bible, but it's not something, obviously, that I would consider moral or good. I don't know how you can say that God didn't condone, according to the stories, what Jephthah did. because Jephthah made a deal with God, let me win this war, and I'll sacrifice the person who comes out of my house. And then Jephthah did what he promised to God. Now, God knew he was going to sacrifice that he shouldn't let him win the war. It doesn't say afterwards that, yeah, God was happy with Jephthah doing it. But the story is presented there as one of a covenant with God that is carried out and fulfilled. There's no objection there from the God. So I'd say that there's at least a condoning by implication, not even just silence, but by the fact that the story is there to present a position.
Well, if all the judges of Israel were presented in a good light, and he was one of them, that may work, but many of them aren't presented in a good light, and many of them did actions that God found reprehensible. So, but anyway, we're getting off topic.
Yeah, sorry. It's fun this way.
My question is for Matt. When you were talking about holding the sandwiches hostage, what is it that you suggest that someone would do to prove what they believe? You said they should first prove their theory or whatever, and then, you know, let the people decide, which I mean, I believe in letting the people decide, but what is it that you think, how would they go about proving that to somebody? And even if they did that, would you think would prove it, would you believe it?
The answer to your second question is yes. I am unrelenting in that I follow the evidence wherever it leads, and I'm willing to change my mind when the evidence dictates that. The crux of your question, which I'm asked a lot, is basically, what would it take to convince me that a God exists? How would somebody go about proving that? And my answer has changed dramatically. I used to give answers, and I had big discussions with people, and my mind was changed somewhat by P.Z. Myers and others. I have no idea, but I can say this. If there's a God that qualifies as a God, that God certainly knows what could change my mind. And if it's a God that cares about me, he's not only willing, but should be capable and willing to do that. And so I don't need to know what it is, but when it happens, how can you deny it? And even as a Christian, that's the view somewhat that I would have had, that this personal experience that I thought I had had was undeniable. I now think it was deniable. But I don't need to know, and it would be mindfully arrogant to think that I could know. I mean, if we're talking about something that transcends everything that I can't even properly grasp and conceive in my mind, but anything that's that big and that powerful that qualifies for any moniker of God should certainly be able to do it. I don't know why he's either unwilling or incapable to do it in my case. I don't know why, for example, Saul was more deserving of a Damascus Road experience than I am. Now, I get letters all the time from people who tell me how much they love me, and that it's clear that God is doing a powerful work in my life, and any day now, he's going to turn me back to the ministry, and I will be the best Christ representative on the planet. And that's frustrating and sweet, but frustrating. Because that would just really irk me. I mean, if I found out that there was a God and he had like toyed with me all this time and refused to reveal himself when I was desperate and continued to be, but when it was seeking the most, what kind of prankster God is that? I mean, well, he sees the bigger picture and sees the path that you're going. Yes, perhaps that's true, but boy, is this weird.
Mr. Allison, first quickly a comment. I thought it was strange that when answering the first questioner's question, you referred to the story of the woman taken in adultery, mm-hmm. when that's pretty well known to be a very late addition to the Bible, and you referred to it as though it was an accounting of real events. So I thought that was odd, but quickly my question is that it seems to me that the central defining feature of morality is personal responsibility. And it seems to me that the point of Christianity is to find a way to sidestep that. And since your fate is not contingent upon either the real harms you cause with your actions in life, nor on your ability or willingness to take personal responsibility for them, but merely with what you happen to believe, how can it be called a moral system at all?
Let me answer that first question. Well, maybe not even a question, an observation. Scholars call that the pericope adulterae, the woman caught in adultery. And yes, it almost definitely is a later addition. And yet, that doesn't mean it's not a historical event.
And in the sovereignty of God, it's in our Bibles. My conviction has always been we have the Bible now that God wanted us to have. And if he's a sovereign God, he would think that would be true. So I'm not going to... And there are other passages that relate to a similar kind of concern of God with people that like her. So as far as personal responsibility goes, the whole theme of the New Testament is about love and treating each other the way you would want to be treated. Pure religion is taking care of orphans and widows. Christians should be, when they're demonstrating the fact that they are followers of God, the people that are out in the forefront taking care of people that are defenseless. And when that doesn't happen, then we're not following in the path of Christ, and we're not reflecting his character. So certainly Christians aren't perfect, and there are examples of that. There's also examples of Christians doing amazing things. Mother Teresa, for example.
I nodded, and I was nodding right along with you when you said the name, but I'll just say
that. All right, I know. He's got a few things. I could probably say Pascal's wager and make him do the same thing. But I never thought that was a good one either, so I'm not going to do that. But my point is, there are, when you follow the precepts and the guidelines that are outlined in the New Testament, a moral person is what you end up being. You can choose not to follow those and end up somewhere else. But that's a natural consequence of following the commands to love your neighbor as yourself and love God with your whole heart.
And quickly, because I don't want to give long answers, if you go to wiki.ironchariots.org, which is a counter-apologetic wiki I run, I've done a verse-by-verse deconstruction of the Sermon on the Mount, because I get tired of people saying just how wonderful it was. And while I agree there's plenty of good things in there, I think there's some bad things in there, some bad advice. I don't find it to be a good guide to being a moral person. I think it advocates victim creation. I think it's one of the reasons why we see a Christian majority that just loves to claim they're being persecuted, because that means that the devil's really out to get them and they're really being tried, when really it might just be that they are disparaging everybody else who doesn't agree with them.
I have a question that was inspired by references that each of you made. For Mark, do you believe it's important that we know the religious affiliations of our political candidates, not just whether they're Christian or not, but to their actual denomination? And for Matt, you made a reference to 1,000 years. Do you believe that if humans are still around 1,000 years from now, that religion will be seen, as Arthur Clarke said in 3001, that religion will be seen as a form of insanity? Or, in other words, which way do you think the pendulum is going to swing towards, more religion or more secularism?
I
have a question for Marcus.
You go first, and I'll...
Yeah, because I went last night.
Yeah.
I'm being sincere. I think it's inevitable that reality is going to win out. And as far as I can tell, reality is a reality without a God. And so I think religion is going to follow the same path that it's followed throughout history, which is religions are born, they live for a while, and they die off. But they don't ever completely die off. I actually get email from people who still believe in the great gods, or say they do. I think that eventually religion will get to the point where it's about as popular as like the Flat Earth Society, or at least the religions that we see now. But I think there will be new religions, because we're humans and we're fallible, and we are so enamored of our own intellect and our intuition and our inductive reasoning that we make mistakes and we just run right through with the mistakes. And I don't know if you want me to chime in the other question, but I just go with Article 6 of the Constitution that says there'll be no religious test for any public office or trust. But I also care about what people believe. So I don't have a right to ask, but if they offer it up, I certainly have a right to choose.
They're leaning back.
Yeah, travel otherwise.
Who's been praying?
I told a couple of my friends that if it started going badly for me, to hit the fire alarm.
it probably should have been hit a while ago, but they didn't like it. So, as far as the question on political parties, I think I'm stepping out a little bit of speaking for the a theistic worldview when I comment on that, but I would certainly want a moral person, whatever his faith or beliefs, and I think we've shown that you can be an atheist and be a moral person. I want somebody that that followed an ethical moral code, and that would. Martin Luther said, I thought this was interesting. His perspective was that government should be as limited as possible. That Christians shouldn't affect the government itself, and because his point was that if you try to make people Christians and they're not, they're not going to become Christians anyway, and they're just going to rebel against that. So, for his position was the government should be as much hands off as possible and just do the necessary things that it needed to do, and let people follow the dictates of their own heart. And as far as I'm concerned, that sounded good to me.
I sound like I'm piling on, but Mark, this question is also for you.
Yeah.
Back on the topic of tonight, being good without God, can you name a tangible benefit, and I define tangible as being demonstrably real, a tangible benefit or a tangible moral good that religion offers that can also be achieved without religion or through some other secular avenue?
That's a good question. The issue isn't that that it can't be. Is that if you follow logically the outcome of a particular worldview, is that going to be the result or not? Logically, the outcome from a Judeo-Christian worldview is that we're going to love our neighbors as ourselves. We're going to love God. We're going to take care of widows and orphans. We're going to follow follow after Christ and pattern our lives after him. We're going to be moral people and honest and good, and that's the natural progression from a theistic Christian worldview. From an atheist worldview where you don't have absolute moral guidelines, that those kind of things don't naturally follow. You can still be a perfectly moral, good person. You can be a person that's better than a Christian, but those things don't naturally follow from a materialist worldview.
I don't have anything to add.
Okay, I have a question.
You look familiar.
You've already asked a question.
So you go ahead.
If the guys behind you haven't asked questions, do you think that's responsible behavior? I don't
know. Anyway, you're not a good question.
I'm sorry.
Beat me up.
Yeah, I'm kidding.
Well, someone wanted me to ask you, why don't you leave the cult, and what's your justification for it? And Mark, you keep trying to justify what you're saying by referring to the Bible. What I want to know is, how do you justify that as a justification? And if it's personal experience, you claim that I've had personal experience, but I don't think I have. And if I have, maybe God's given me personal experience, but obviously it's not enough to convince me.
So trying to justify the Bible from personal experience, I guess I'm not exactly. Are you trying to justify Christianity without relying on personal experience?
Why do you consider the Bible to be a good guide for immoral behavior?
Or why do you consider it, you keep using that, like you keep, for your evidence of why it's...
Well, I'm trying to present a theistic worldview, so it is also my worldview, but I'm trying to present it in a way that would apply to anybody, whether you're a whatever denomination you're with. The Bible, what Christians believe is that there is general revelation, which is the evidence of God that we see in nature. And so the Bible says that when you look around, that the things of God are clearly seen in the things that he has made. Then there's special revelation, which is the Bible. It's the story, the accounts of God's dealing with people. The Bible's not like a magic book or anything. It is inspired, but it's not magic. And so it's a story. There are accounts of how God dealt with his people. And so as we take those timeless truths
and then apply them to our lives, it makes sense and it works. And you know, that one of the reasons I'm a Christian is because it works. It makes me a better person. I attend a church where I see lives changed all the time. People that are broken and hurting, and their lives are they're changed. And so, pragmatically, I apply the principles that I see in the Bible, and it works.
So, in your question to me about why I'm of the cult, I addressed it many times on the show. There's clips online that tell my whole background. I touched on it a bit earlier. I don't want to drag this out any longer. I don't believe, because a sincere and honest search for evidence able to produce anything and produce evidence in opposition.
So did you have faith at all?
Sure, I used to have lots of faith. Now I find I don't have faith in anything.
But isn't faith in the things that are unseen?
I want to let this guy get his question. I'll be happy to come back to address that, but he's been waiting a long time.
Yeah, my question is the Bible, matter of fact. For Matt, you know, either you believe it or not, 25 years, you believe it, or then 25 years later, I'm an atheist. But the question, you say you believe in 1 Peter 3:15, and I believe in 2 Timothy 2:15, by the way. But are you, based on what you say, with Jephthah's vow and certain other things, you believe there is contradiction to it. What is your view about the Bible? And what if you're wrong, is my second part. What is your view, and what if you're wrong?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks for both. My view of the Bible is pretty simple. The Bible is a chronicle of a collection of people's best attempts to understand the world that they were living in and their place in it. It's a collection of myths and legends, not any different, or not dramatically different from others. It's the one that was perhaps most or second most successful in actually appealing to people. And the one thing that religions are good at is setting up, as they've grown and changed, is setting up a protective mechanism around them. This idea that the religions that are easy to challenge have died off. The religions that are really good at protecting themselves, perhaps in obfuscation or in appeals to mystery and things like that, tend to linger around because they provide people with hope. My question is whether or not the hope is actually real. Now, as to what if I'm wrong, it's a version of Pascal's wager. It's Kirk Cameron's go-to version of Pascal's wager. The quick answer to what if I'm wrong is I'll find out, and I'll certainly admit that I was wrong. It's not, you know, it's not like I wouldn't sit there in the face of a god and say, nope, you don't admit this, it's crazy. But I would have a lot of questions, and one of the things is, even if I were to discover that the God of the Bible, for example, exists, and I found this out before I was dead, I could no longer be an atheist. I would definitely believe that this God existed. Whether or not I would worship this God is a whole other question. And it would depend on the sort of answers that this God provided for the things that have been attributed to him. Because the existence of God is not necessarily the existence of a good God. And certainly, I find it baffling that any God that could be considered good would care about worship or reverence. Any God that created human beings and gave them intellect with which to solve every other question about the universe, but expected you to suspend intellect and rely on faith for the single most important question of existence, is crazy. And so I don't feel the need to worship anything. And if there was a God that needed worship, I'm baffled by it. I've often likened the character of the God in Christianity with a mafia boss. That, you know, you do your things and you show your reverence to me and you're covered. And as soon as you're not, we're going to come around and break thumbs. And I realize that's a caricature, and I'm not trying to overly belittle anybody's beliefs, because there's many different Christian beliefs and takes on Christianity as they are Christians. And some of them are some of the nicest people I've ever met, some of them are friends and family, and I love them. But when I'm talking about the Bible and the character of God as represented in the Bible, That's my take on it. And if I'm wrong and he exists, what can I do about it? The idea that God can squash me like a bug is something that I can do nothing about. And if hell is a literal place, and if I am sent forever to a hell because I refused to sacrifice reason, I will go to that hell knowing that I am more moral than the being who sent me there.
My question is somewhat similar to the Isaac and Abraham dilemma that was posed earlier. Both certainly comment on it. But firstly, if God came to you tomorrow in a vision, and in that vision he asked you to commit violence on an innocent person, and when you asked him, why do you need me to do this, and he said, well, I work in mysterious ways, but this is more of my plan. In fact, it's integral to my plan that you do this. Would you go on and commit that act of violence? And if you wouldn't that go against the notion that God is a source of morality? Because if he is a source of morality, wouldn't it make sense to follow whatever fiat or command that he handed down to you?
That's a good question. The answer is no, I wouldn't. If there is a God, and there is, logically, he has to be a good God, because goodness is, evil is a warping of goodness. So what we know of good is there because God is good. God wouldn't tell you to go hurt somebody because he is a good God, and that is evidenced in the life of Jesus that we see in the New Testament. And so if we're following the pattern of Jesus Christ, who said, do good to others and love the Lord with all your heart, if even in a vision I knew for sure this was God asking me to do something, I wouldn't do it, because in his word he reveals himself as something different.
You get the last, almost last word. We get the last word.
Yeah. My question is more directed to you, Matt. I know how you say, oh, I want evidence of certain, there's a God or whatever. But like my evidence, like I lived in Beirut for 10 years. And there's this family there that has these two paintings, one of Mary, one of Jesus. And each one of them drips oil. Like, no one knows why. They've been tested. People have come and gone to the house. I personally believe in, like, miracles. And many people over there think that it is a miracle. And, like, people that have gone to visit the paintings, have been to themselves with oil, have had other miracles done to them as well, and they keep writing the family back and forth. I just want to know, like, what your take is on abnormal things, I guess, that happen in the world.
Sure. There's a lot of claims like this, and what I find interesting is you talk about how they've been tested, as if they've been confirmed. I see no evidence that they've actually been tested. And by the way, if anybody thinks that they've seen any can demonstrate any sort of supernatural claim like that, they should contact the James Randi Educational Foundation. That's not just to beat up the millions of miracle claims that are out there. My take on this is that I have no good reason to believe that it's actually true, but let's say that we actually did have a team of scientists go and investigate this, and they came up with just, this is happening and we can't explain it. That's as far as we can get. At that point, it is the unexplained. It is a mystery. We can keep investigating it, and maybe someday we'll find out what the actual explanation is. But you cannot answer a mystery by appealing to a greater mystery. We explain things in terms of things that we understand. And so when you find a miracle like that, the best we can get to at this point is, I don't know what causes this, let's keep looking. You don't get to the, I don't know what causes this, therefore it must be God. Because that is a logical non sequitur. Just as, it, I won't say, I don't want to do that because I don't want to end hitting you for something. The miracle claims that are out there, why haven't those people, the scientists that investigated them, won the Nobel Prize for proving God? Why isn't this front page news around the world? Is there some grand conspiracy among scientists to keep down the miraculous? Aren't we all looking for something miraculous every day? I think that what's happening, or at least the evidence that I have so far, we know that a number of these have been faked. Others, we have no idea whether they've been faked. And in those situations, the best thing we can say is, I don't know. And as a final little thing on that, Mark's been talking about giving the theistic position. I'm not here giving the atheist position. I'm here giving my atheist position, because on many of these things, there is no the atheist anything. Atheism is just the rejection of God claims, and everything else is from everything else. But I'm a fan of I don't know. And not no answer that I've given here tonight is proffered dogmatically or should be accepted as such. You should investigate, think about it, and like any scientific explanation, you should accept it tentatively and change your mind when the evidence says you should. So when the evidence is such that miracles somehow become believable, I'll believe.
Miracles happen all the time. I see them in our church every day. People's lives are changed. Addicts are healed from their addictions. Seen physical healings. Remember my daughter when she was a baby, just something very simple, like she had thrush in her mouth, just this white and stuff. We went up for prayer at an Episcopal church. They anointed her. By the time she got back to her seat, it was gone. Just something seems minor. To me, the big miracles that you see in the New Testament aren't the people getting raised from the dead, other than Christ. But things like Lazarus, it's the transformed lives, the things that someone who, like in the story of Zacchaeus, a person that is a Jewish man, but a tax collector for the Romans and a traitor to his faith and his people, and yet with one word from Christ, his life has changed. Those are the kind of miracles that appeal to me, transformed lives, and we see that all the time at our church.
Apparently, the monkey barrel closes at 10 o'clock. So, we're going to go to Wild Wings, which is in the same area. Anybody that needs directions, just come and find me or somebody else that knows in the end. Now, we're going to give each one of them 3 minutes to just do a 3-minute little sum up, and we're all done. Make donations. Thanks.
I can make this much shorter than 3 minutes. I talk a lot and I give long answers. I didn't prepare anything special to close with. And I thought I was closing a minute ago. So I'll let that stand and let Mark finish.
I would just want to conclude by saying that I really appreciate that all of you took this long to stay here. A lot of you traveled a long way to get here. And just the fact that that you're willing to engage with us in this kind of discussion, it's great. One of the things I just want to point out is that some Christians may be afraid of open debate, but that's certainly not a characteristic or an element of the Christian faith. God is a God who's not afraid to engage with your mind. He created it, I appreciate you all being here.
How's everybody doing? Everybody good? Yeah. Did we divide up? Did we sit like at a wedding where the people on this side? the question that's put before us today, this good without God question mark, it's kind of baffling. It's one of the things that when we're talking about possibly having debates, it's picking a subject. And this is a question that to me makes no sense at all. I mean, if you begin with Psalm 14:1, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God, they are corrupt, their works are vile, they can do no good. So there's at least one passage in the Bible that specifically says that because I don't believe in a God, because I actually believe that there are no gods, I can do nothing good. Does anybody actually think that that's true, that I can do no good? You think, okay, cool. There are plenty of people who don't have a God belief, who do good things. Marie Curie, Warren Buffett, you're talking about philanthropists and people doing just generally good things, but we have an atheist helping the homeless group in Austin area. But more important than that, in figuring out, oh, you did something special, I do plenty of things myself that I would just generally consider good, like loving my family and helping other people and working to make the world, at least as far as I can tell, a better place. I'd like to think that the psalmist was engaging in a little hyperbole, kind of like a we rock, you suck type thing, to kind of amp up his own group. But you've got this idea that sticks with people, and in Matthew 7, you've got Jesus talking about how you'll by their fruits will you know them, and a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, bad tree cannot bear good fruit, etc., which kind of reinforces this idea. It's an idea that we know is wrong about fruit trees, and we also know that it's wrong about human beings. We know people of all beliefs can do good, and we know people of all beliefs can do bad. And I would point you to the pedophile priest scandals, amongst other things, to show that people who generally profess a belief, I cannot possibly assess whether or not they are true believers. That's not my job. I don't get to determine who's a true Christian and who isn't. I didn't even get to do it when I was a Christian for 25 years. It's not my job. If there is a God, it's his. And it would be silly of me to try and sort all that out. But this idea that we can't be good without God is one that I almost think doesn't even need to be addressed anymore. But because it's on there today, I wanted to at least make sure that we talked about it a little bit. The question, there's a number of challenges that are often raised to secular moral positions. One of them is that, you simply can't be good without God, which I think we can pretty much demonstrate is not true, unless we have some really weird definition of good. And then we move on to things like, well, you're only good because God wrote it in your heart, or you're only good because you are surrounded by morally good Christians who guide you. Those are some of the more common ones. And so my question kind of is Christianity, and you'll forgive my focus on Christianity, I think it's predominant in the room, in the area, there are the broader arguments apply to other religions as well, moral? And my answer is no. Christianity doesn't have within it a moral system. And that baffles people when I say that, but it's true. It has a legal system that addresses subjects of morality. The Euthyphro dilemma, raised in ancient times by the Greeks, was, is something moral, I'm paraphrasing obviously, is something moral because God commands it, or does God command it because it's moral? If something is moral because God commands it, then morality is nothing other than divine declaration and fiat, and can change on a whim. And if God is the author of morality, and whatever he speaks is necessarily moral, then telling you to slaughter someone is necessarily moral. If it's the other way around, that God merely tells you things that are already intrinsically moral, then what use do we have for God? Clearly we can discover things that are intrinsically morally good on our own. We do it all the time. So you don't actually have what I would consider to be a moral system. What you have is a list of laws, or a set of commands that seemingly do not change. There are a number of apologetic responses to this, and I don't know if Mark's going to address any of them or not. But the question is it more accurate, the laws that Christianity has about morality, is it more accurate, is it more moral than those that we can come up with from a secular perspective? And again, the answer is no. If we began with the Bible, as I would think most Christians do, the Bible clearly is not a moral guidebook. You may, whether you think it was literally, you should take it literally, that it was inspired directly by God and everything in there is a moral precept. I think that idea fails as soon as we mention slavery. Or if you think it's just the best wisdom of the men of their times who were trying to understand God, I think it still fails because you can't get anything out of it. You cannot, you have no authority other than the individual interpretation. And it's the reason why you have thousands of denominations within Christianity. Oh, I'm at the stopping point.
Just a couple more sentences.
I will wrap it up then. Second, moral systems have an advantage in that they have a way to deal with this problem of conflict. That religion, that's a challenge that religions often say that, that secular morality can't solve. And in fact, secular morality systems are the only ones that can.
Okay, thank you very much. We will now have a 5-minute opening statement from Mark Allison of the Covenant Connections Church.
Appreciate you all being here, and thank you, David, y'all, for letting me be here. I hope that's the hardest thing I have to do tonight, is pronounce your name. But yeah, this is an honor and a privilege, especially being able to talk alongside Matt. I don't know if any of you all have ever seen any of his YouTube videos that are out there. They're interesting. And I was watching the best of, and that's especially good. And there was one, he'll get these Christian callers that just get so frustrated and don't know how to articulate what they want to say. And one guy, I correct me if I'm wrong, said something like, I'm going to come over and punch you in the head in Jesus' name. So I figure I'll keep that as my low standard for what I want to achieve tonight. And hope y'all love that. And we'll see. But it's good. So just a little bit about me. I'm very surprised that more people won't come out and discuss Christianity with people that have opposing views. I mean, if Christianity is true, and I believe it is, then it should be able to stand up to that kind of debate. And we'll see if I can articulate those kind of ideas tonight. Let me just tell you a little bit about myself in general. I grew up in the Middle East where my parents were missionaries. We were in Jordan for a little while, in a little village out in the desert, and fighting started, and we evacuated to Beirut, which didn't turn out to be a lot better. This was in the early 70s, so they evacuated all the Americans out of Beirut. Ended up growing up on a college campus in North Georgia at Tocoa Falls College, so I almost had no chance other than to end up being a Christian, right? So I was probably born a Christian, just kidding. Can't get there that way. But interestingly, when I got to Tocoa, the first guy I met, his name was David, we're good friends, and David's dad was the head of the Bible and Theology Department, my dad the head of the Missions Department, and David's been an atheist his whole life and still is an atheist, so you can be the son of a Bible theology professor and it still works out that way. David's a great guy, so I know from personal experience that atheists can be good, and we have some good discussions very often. So, just want to attach on to what Matt was talking about. When Psalms is talking about the fool and his heart says there's no God, it's saying that within the context of the Israelite culture. And so he's talking to Israelites when he's talking about the difference between people that are foolish and people that are wise, not necessarily categorizing atheists in that kind of light. And as far as Christianity not being a moral system, and it just being a list of laws, one class of them are going through the Old Testament, and they get through Genesis, and there's some great stories in there. Exodus, good stories too. You get into Leviticus, and you agree with Matt 100%. All it is a list of laws. And I don't know, has anybody here ever tried to read through the Bible in a year before? I've gotten through Deuteronomy like so many times, and it ended there. And did not get past. I got to do one of those other things where you start in the New Testament or something, because there's a bunch of laws. But one of my main ideas about how let me continue on because it gives some context. My master's degree is in anthropology from the University of Georgia. Go Dawgs!
And this is a great university here too. You're kind of part of it, right? So I guess that all works. When God had to deal with a bunch of slaves that had been slaves for 400 years, and he had to get them out of there, out of Egypt, into another land that was full of atheists. No, I'm just kidding. They were actually theists, and that's where some of the names for God actually even came from. El and so forth is a Canaanite name. So he's trying to get these people that had been atheists, that had been in Egypt for 400 years, didn't know anything about God except for what Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had told them. And so he's trying to teach them what it means to be holy and moral people. And so these laws were given in order to do that. So, and that's all I have time to talk about. So.
Okay, now we will start with some prearranged questions. And these questions were generated by students. They don't necessarily reflect the beliefs of the students for the Secular Alliance, the BFI Club, SBS, or any of the other sponsoring organizations. What will happen is we will first ask the question. I will ask one gentleman alternating between who will go first and second. After a question is posed, each person will have 3 minutes to give an answer, and then we'll go on to 7 questions. After that period, we will have a period of open mic where anybody can direct any question to any individual. And the first question is going to go to Mark Allison. He'll have 3 minutes, and then Matt Dillahunty will have 3 minutes to respond. And here's the first question. Again, it's not mine. It's just was developed by students, as are the other 6 questions. So the first question is, Merriam-Webster defines good as a favorable character or tendency. Is it possible to be good without God? Why or why not? First, Mark Allison.
Yes, of course, atheists can be good people. They can be better people sometimes than Christians, as is evidenced by the guy that was going to punch Matt in the head in Jesus' name, right? I don't think that's the issue right here. If you you cannot believe in God and you can be a good person, you can recycle, you cannot beat your kids and your wife and your dog. You can do things that we would all consider good, and you can do all those things without believing in God. The question, however, is not can you be a good person and believe in God or not believe in God. The question is, can you be a good person without God? And that's entirely different. What you're saying there, the question you're asking is, if there is no God, can you still be good? Can you still have moral categories like good and evil if there is no God that defines those moral categories as good and evil? Does that make sense? All right. So I'm going to read a little bit from William Lane Craig, because he articulates this better than I can. If God exists, our values are simply social niceties defined by our culture. Something like shaking somebody's hand if we don't believe in absolute moral categories. If God exists, then the objectivity of moral values is secured, but if God does not exist, then morality is completely subjective and non-binding. We might act in precisely the same ways that we do, in fact, act, but in the absence of God, such actions would no longer count as good or evil, since if God doesn't exist, objective moral values don't exist. What precisely are objective moral values? To say that they're objective moral values is to say that something is right or wrong independently of whether anybody believes it to be so. It is to say, for example, that Nazi anti-Semitism was morally wrong, even though the Nazis who carried out the Holocaust thought it was good, and it would still be wrong even if the Nazis had won World War II and succeeded in exterminating or brainwashing everybody who disagreed with them. It would also mean that the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition were wrong, even though it was done in the name of the Church. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, objective moral values are rooted in God. God's own holy and perfectly good nature supplies its absolute standard against which all actions and decisions are measured. He is by nature loving, generous, just, faithful, kind, and good, and so forth. So on this foundation, we can affirm the objective goodness and rightness of love, generosity, self-sacrifice, inequality, and condemn as objectively evil and wrong things like selfishness, hatred, abuse, discrimination, and oppression.
Okay, and we'll now have up to a 3-minute rebuttal by Matt Dillahunty.
Sure, and I want to thank Mark for quoting William Lane Craig, because I've been trying to debate Craig, but he won't debate anybody who doesn't have a PhD, so it's been avoided. Craig's take on this is just bizarrely wrong. First of all, I'm not a moral relativist, and neither are most of the atheists that I interact with. And if you read, for example, Sam Harris's Moral Landscape, you'll get a good outline of a secular moral system that has that is vehemently in opposition to moral relativism. The idea that cultural ideas dictate morality is simply false and stupid. On that part, Craig's right. On the idea that you cannot have objective morality without a God, Craig is absolutely wrong. When Muslims engage in female genital mutilation, that's a cultural difference, and it's also grossly immoral. And everybody can observe this. Morals are about the interaction between thinking minds. We are the ones that imbue the reality that we experience with value. We are the ones that are engaged in the actions, and we are the ones that interact with others. And so you begin with very simple precepts, the idea that life is generally preferable to death, happiness is generally preferable to sadness, health is preferable to sickness. And you build off of these foundational premises, and you evaluate the actions and the consequences of those actions within the scope of that system. Now, does that mean that there's a single, absolutely correct moral position for any given situation? Not necessarily. It's one of the reasons why Sam Harris uses the moral landscape, that there are various peaks. But it doesn't mean, the fact that we don't know everything about interacting with others and about societal health doesn't mean we know nothing. And it doesn't mean that there aren't objective right and wrongs. Just as when we talk about health, people may have different opinions about health. But it's objectively true that as a human being, drinking battery acid is bad for you. And it doesn't become good for you just because some other culture thinks that they can do it. And if we find somebody who actually does benefit from drinking battery acid, we have the scientific process to study that and figure out how it is that they're different from us and what we can learn from it and continue on from there. The idea that there is necessarily a God required in order for there to be some sort of objective morals is nonsense. The God required as the essence of and dictator of moral values is nothing but divine command theory, no matter how Craig would like to disguise it. That's all I have to say on that.
Your friend is involved in a healthy, happy marriage, but tells you that occasionally he looks at other women and sometimes even dreams about other women. He asks your opinion on the subject. What is your opinion on this subject? First you, then Mark House.
Sure. First, I don't think his dreams matter at all. I don't know that you can actually be held responsible for the things that you dream, or we'd all be in big
trouble.
Thank
God. We're gonna
but the other thing is, you know, this goes back to the way we define ourselves, and we've done a really bad job of falling into patterns about defining humans and human behavior and misunderstanding who we are and thinking we all fit into neat little boxes. We started with, you know, this privilege and predisposition towards, for example, heterosexuality. And then it was, well, maybe you're gay or straight. Well, then maybe you're gay, straight, or bi. And then maybe we discover that there's this broad spectrum of human sexuality. And we find the same thing in relationships. We find people who are monogamous. We find people who are polyamorous. And there's a broad spectrum of these. And I'm not going to get into, you know, unless I'm asked to discuss it, which ones are potentially moral or immoral. But on this particular question, where he's struggling with the idea that he's perhaps fantasizing about other women or seeing them, then my response to him is, have you talked to your wife about this? Because I don't know that, you know, I don't know what would be the nature of your relationship, but not in every relationship is this necessarily a problem. Denying who we are as human creatures and making us seem bad or wrong or born bad or wrong, or that lust is a sin, it seems to me perverse, because I don't know a single marriage, Christian, Muslim, or otherwise, that doesn't survive on a little bit of lust. I mean, it drives the procreation thing. And so, while I don't think it's necessarily healthy, if you're in a monogamous relationship, to spend your time overly engaged in fantasies about other people, it's not always completely unhealthy. And the best thing that he can do is talk to his wife, because open and honest communication is what builds an actual relationship. Keeping things secret is what destroys them. maybe she would be okay with it. Maybe she's not, but until you actually have that conversation and figure out what footing your relationship's on, you can't know.
Okay, thank you very much. And now we'll have a 3-minute response, or up to 3 minutes, by Mark Allison.
I love what Matt said about open and communication with your wife. That's 100% true. Interestingly, you know, on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is redefining some of the Old Testament morality. In the Old Testament, if you committed adultery, it was a sin. Jesus is saying, you've heard it said, interestingly, the person that said it was God, and Moses was the one that gave the command. So Jesus is definitely equating himself with God there, and he's saying, you've heard it said, if you look, you know, if you commit adultery, it's a sin, but I say if you even look at a woman with lust in her in your heart. I don't think he was talking about your wife, by the way, but another woman besides your wife, then it's a sin. I think, one of the main differences between a materialist and a Christian theist is that we believe that we are more than just a body, just a physical being. You're actually, and it's not even a body with a soul. You're actually a soul that has a body. And so there are a lot of ramifications when you're, you know, that are involved when you're doing something like lust. You're not just affecting your physical body. You're affecting yourself, your the real true being that you are. And
for a reason, because there is an element of faith. There's a lot of an element of faith. It's also grounded in history, and so it's not totally faith, but it's there. But faith is there for a reason. Have you ever played that game where you fall back and someone's there to catch you? What's it called?
Trust fall.
Yeah. So, you ever have anybody miss you and fall? But the idea there is that, there's an element of faith. You're trusting that person that you after you've performed that, you have a concrete faith in them based on experience. And God does the same kind of thing with us. Faith is not there just because God wants to dangle something in front of you that you can't see and then blame you when you can't catch it. Faith is there to strengthen that part of you that is spirit, because God is spirit too, and it enhances that relationship that you have because it's spirit-based.
And I was going to actually address it fairly quickly. It's called the trust fall. And I actually make a distinction between trust and faith. And trust is something you grant that's either rewarded or not, and you base your decisions on that based on what you've petered out. Faith, in my definition, is faith is the reason people give for believing, or the excuse I often say people give for believing something when they don't have a good reason. Because if you have a good reason, then you wouldn't make any appeal to faith. I'm a non-believer now, in particular, because I took 1 Peter 3:15 very seriously, which, as far as I was concerned, instructed every Christian to be prepared at all times to give a reason for the faith, which now I see as somewhat contradictory. But the reason there is translated from the Greek logos. So I took it to be a logical reason. Now, that may have been a mistake on my part. But this idea that God will reveal himself to anybody who sincerely seeks is one that I find absolutely frustrating, because I cannot prove it to you or to anybody else, and it wouldn't matter if I could. I am not aware of anybody who more earnestly and honestly sought out God. I was already a believer. I had the feeling that I was running from a call to the ministry, and that I have this time and this opportunity and this money. And so I spent 18 months or so in serious study and prayer. I didn't just memorize Bible verses so I could come here and toss them out today. This was who I was. And if my sincere attempt to communicate with God did not have that result, then that statement seems kind of empty to me. And absurd, because I can't imagine anybody who would endeavor to do more than I did at the time. And it's incredibly frustrating, because the number of people who claim these revelations and have absolutely no knowledge about the theology that they have accepted and could not have done an engaging discussion like this tonight is back in that current. They may not be telling the truth. I don't know. Like I said, I have no way of telling who's a true Christian, who's not. But the idea that if you ask, God will reveal himself to you is, you'd have to take it on faith that it didn't happen to me. But boy, is that frustrating. Because it makes me out to be a liar and dishonest, and neither of those six.
Okay, the hour is, let's see, it is 8:38. We're going to try to get this done, I think, by 9. So the remaining people will be the only ones off the questions. So we ask these 10 questions to be fairly succinct as well as the answers. Thank you.
Hey, Matt. Hey, Mark.
Hey.
I have a question that's like speaking to Eddie Long and all of those ministers and people in religion who do something and do something wrong that's against society. And what if what if Eddie Long basically was praying every night, please Lord, don't let me be attracted to young boys, please, 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 please. And don't let me do anything, and then he does it. And in a sense, he is let down by this God. I mean, he's let down, and how that plays into the church itself, into his followers, and how they are, in a sense, let down by this God. And I'd like for you to speak to that, but real quickly, what that says to me, that's pretty painful to watch. To watch people who follow this belief system, and then they're let down like that. And I feel so sad for them because of that. And that kind of speaks to what Matt was saying, one of his atheist experiences that went viral, when you were talking about how emotionally it hurts when you see people wrapped up into this religion, and how painful it is for the non-believer to see people following and they get let down like that. So could both of you speak to that? Thank you.
Yeah, I find it painful to watch evangelists on TV too. My wife usually tells me I'm going to hell for the things I say when I watch them. So she might be right.
You'll be a good company,
buddy. Yeah. But it's hard to blame God for what Eddie Long did. None of us are perfect, and the Bible perfection isn't what gets you into heaven. Being good isn't what gets you in heaven. It's a relationship with God that does that. Again, like I said before, all of Christianity is about relationship with God from beginning to end. And when we fall, he's there to help us pick up the pieces.
And I just say that I think this has nothing to do with the truth of any religion. Religions and religious organizations have done the entire planet a huge disservice by disguising mental issues, mental health issues. They used to do it with appeals to demonic possession, and now they do it by hiding the perpetrators and shuffling them down to different, or shuffling around to different parishes. We've done a lot. Thank you. We've done a lot of improvement. You know, I talk about morality being analogous to health. We know quite a bit about human physical health. We're getting a little better about human mental health. If I could put words in Mark's mouth, I think Mark would think that we probably need to get better about human spiritual health. In my case, what I take to be the equivalent of that human spiritual health is it's certainly metaphoric, and it has to do with our interactions with each other. And we need to wake people up and stop hiding mental illnesses and stop protecting people who are harming other people and get them help. I have no idea anything about Eddie Long, whether he was guilty or not. I followed it beyond the initial accusations because I'm frankly bored. It's sad. I'm bored of accusations of pedophiles in the clergy. How can you get bored of that? We should be screaming and yelling. What happened at Penn State, they rioted because Joe Pa got fired. He should have got fired. All of them should have got fired. Somebody, when they came across that man in their raping of war, should have been fired. I think Penn State is analogous to religion in this way. They had football was their religion. Joe Pa was their pope. And they were going to protect him at all costs, even at the cost of little kids. None of us. It's not, is there anybody in the room that disagrees with that? We are all way better than that. Okay.
Amen.
You can tell me why later.
Okay.
Cool. Next.
Hi, this is a question for both of you. It's a specific moral question. It's a hypothetical. I imagine Marcus has an advantage on this for a couple of reasons. But the example of Abraham and Isaac, the sacrifice Isaac has been alluded to a couple of times. And the question is this. I'd like you to assume for a moment that God exists, that you know he exists, and that he is able to communicate with you in an unambiguous way. And now, I don't know, Mark, I don't know your take on some of the Old Testament stories. I know there are some traditions that consider them more important for their allegorical value than their literal historicity. But there are some rabbinical traditions that actually debate whether or not Abraham failed or passed the test.
He failed.
And so my question for you is, assume there is a God, assume he has communicated with you this command, what is your moral duty to do in the situation with Abraham?
Yeah, it's really quick and easy for me, and that's my view on this change, not only about why Isaac's torment was ignored, but people often claim that the biblical God doesn't sanction human sacrifice, Jeff, the notwithstanding, and that's a separate debate as to whether or not there was or wasn't a sacrifice there. The idea is, I'm Abraham, and I know God exists, and God's going to talk to me, and he commands me to kill my son, and my God is a loving God. The one and only correct answer is, I don't know who you are, but my God would never do this, and there's no way I'm killing my son, go away. And by the way, where is my God to protect me from a monster like you? That's the one and only correct answer. It wasn't a test. You know, this idea that it was a test, God wasn't testing Abraham so God could figure out what Abraham would do. God already knew. The typical thing is God was testing Abraham so Abraham knew what he would do, and he failed, in my opinion. It existed.
I totally disagree. Abraham was coming out of a culture that did engage in human sacrifice. Whatever you believe about Jephthah, by the way, the Bible doesn't condone what he did. And God knew that he was never going to sacrifice Isaac. And what God was, one of the many pictures that was happening there besides is being a picture of what Christ would actually do himself, which was become the sacrifice for all of us so that we could have that relationship with him. Isaac was never going to be killed, but God wanted to let us see a picture of how intense his passion is for us, that he himself would be the one to place himself on that altar instead of Isaac eventually, so that we could all have that relationship with him.
And go ahead, can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
To me, the lesson from that story, when you put it that way, is one of blind obedience, which may be true about the God of the Bible, but it's not something obviously that I would consider moral or good. I don't know how you can say that God didn't condone, according to the stories, what Jephthah did. Because Jephthah made a deal with God, let me win this war, and I'll sacrifice the person who comes out of my house. And then Jephthah did what he promised to God. Now, if God knew he was going to sacrifice, that he shouldn't have let him win the war. It doesn't say afterwards that, yeah, God was happy with Jephthah doing it. But the story is presented there as one of a covenant with God that is carried out and fulfilled. There's no objection there from the God. So I'd say that there's at least a condoning by implication. Not even just silence, but by the fact that the story is there to present a position.
Well, if all the judges of Israel were presented in a good light, and he was one of them, that may work, but many of them aren't presented in a good light, and many of them did actions that God found reprehensible. So, but anyway, we're getting off topic.
Yeah, sorry. it's what I do.
My question is for Matt. When you were talking about holding the sandwiches hostage, what is it that you would suggest that someone would do to prove what they believe? You said they should first prove their theory or whatever, and then, you know, let the people decide, which I mean, I believe in letting the people decide, but what is it that you think, how would they go about proving that to somebody? And even if they did that, would you think would prove it? Would you believe it?
The answer to your second question is yes. I am unrelenting in that I follow the evidence wherever it leads, and I'm willing to change my mind when the evidence dictates that. The crux of your question, which I'm asked a lot, is basically, what would it take to convince me that a God exists? How would somebody go about proving that? And my answer has changed dramatically. I used to give answers, and I had big discussions with people, and my mind was changed somewhat by P.Z. Myers and others. I have no idea, but I can say this. If there's a God that qualifies as a God, that God certainly knows what could change my mind. And if it's a God that cares about me, he's not only willing, but should be capable and willing to do that. And so I don't need to know what it is, but when it happens, how can you deny it? And even as a Christian, that's the view somewhat that I would have had, that this personal experience that I thought I had had was undeniable. I now think it was deniable. But I don't need to know, and it would be mind-blowing arrogant to think that I could know. I mean, if we're talking about something that transcends everything that I can't even properly grasp and conceive in my mind, but anything that's that big and that powerful that qualifies for any moniker of God should certainly be able to do it. I don't know why he's either unwilling or incapable to do it in my case. I don't know why, for example, Saul was more deserving of a Damascus Road experience than I am. Now, I get letters all the time from people who tell me how much they love me, and that it's clear that God is doing a powerful work in my life, and any day now, he's going to turn me back to the ministry, and I will be the best Christ representative on the planet. And that's frustrating and sweet, but frustrating. Because that would just really irk me. I mean, if I found out that there was a God and he had like toyed with me all this time and refused to reveal himself when I was desperate and continued to be, but when it was seeking the most, what kind of Christ or God is that? I mean, well, he sees the bigger picture and sees the path that you're going. Yes, perhaps that's true, but boy, is this weird.
Mr. Allison, first quickly a comment. I thought it was strange that when answering the first questioner's question, you referred to the story of the woman taken in adultery, mm-hmm. when that's pretty well known to be a very late addition to the Bible, and you referred to it as though it was an accounting of real events. So I thought that was odd, but quickly my question is that it seems to me that the central defining feature of morality is personal responsibility. And it seems to me that the point of Christianity is to find a way to sidestep that. And since your fate is not contingent upon either the real harms you cause with your actions in life, nor on your ability or willingness to take personal responsibility for them, but merely with what you happen to believe, how can it be called a moral system at all?
Let me answer that first question. Well, maybe not even a question, an observation. Scholars call that the pericope adulterae, the woman caught adultery. And yes, it almost definitely is a later addition. And yet, that doesn't mean it's not a historical event. And in the sovereignty of God, it's in our Bibles. So my conviction has always been we have the Bible now that God wanted us to have. And if he's a sovereign God, he would think that would be true. So I'm not going to. And there are other passages that relate to a similar kind of concern of God with people that like her. So, and as far as personal responsibility goes, The whole theme of the New Testament is about love and treating each other the way you would want to be treated. Pure religion is it's taking care of orphans and widows. Christians should be, when they're demonstrating the fact that they are followers of God, the people that are out in the forefront taking care of people that need, that are defenseless. And when that doesn't happen, then we're not following in the path of Christ, and we're not reflecting his character. So certainly Christians aren't perfect, and there are examples of that. We have also examples of Christians doing amazing things. Mother Teresa, for example.
I nodded, and I was nodding right along with you when you said the name, but I'll just say
that. All right, I know. He's got a few things. I could probably say Pascal's wager and make him do the same thing. But I never thought that was a good one either, so I'm not going to do that. But my point is, there are, when you follow the precepts and the guidelines that are outlined in the New Testament, a moral person is what you end up being. You can choose not to follow those and end up somewhere else, but that's a natural consequence of following the commands to love your neighbor as yourself and love God with your whole heart.
And quickly, because I don't want to give long answers, if you go to wiki.ironchariots.org, which is a counter-apologetic wiki I run, I've done a verse-by-verse deconstruction of the Sermon on the Mount, because I get tired of people saying just how wonderful it was. And while I agree, there's plenty of good things in there, I think there's some bad things in there, some bad advice, I don't find it to be a good guide to being a moral person. I think it advocates victim creation. I think it's one of the reasons why we see a Christian majority that just loves to claim they're being persecuted, because that means that the devil's really out to get them and they're really being tried, when really it might just be that they are disparaging everybody else who doesn't agree with them.
I have a question that was inspired by references that each of you made. For Mark, do you believe it's important that we know the religious affiliations of our political candidates, not just whether they're Christian or not, but to their actual denomination? And for Matt, you made a reference to 1,000 years. Do you believe that if humans are still around 1,000 years from now, that religion will be seen, as Arthur Clarke said in 3001, that religion will be seen as a form of insanity? Or, in other words, which way do you think the pendulum is going to swing towards, more religion or more secularism?
I
have a question for Marcus.
Sure.
You go first, and I'll...
Yeah, because I went last time.
Yeah.
I'm being sincere. I think it's inevitable that reality is going to win out. And as far as I can tell, reality is... this a reality without a God. And so I think religion
is a beautiful thing. It was created by God. It's Christian, my wife said Christians should have the best sex in the world. And I blush every time I think of that. But it's true. God made it for a reason. And it's not just procreation, although that's part of it. Again, going back to the Christian belief that we are more than just a body, we are also souls. There's a spiritual aspect to what we do when we have sex together. It's not just the interconnectedness of bodies, it's the interconnectedness of souls. And that's why having premarital sex can be devastating emotionally, because you're ripping apart something that wasn't meant to be ripped apart. Of course, there's other consequences too from that, but certainly having these kind of discussions with your children as they're growing up is the way to do it.
Can you guys hear me? Yes. We're going to do questions from the audience, but I want to make sure everyone knows after this, we're going to the Monkey Barrel on the Gainesville Square. So come and meet us there. I wanted to make sure everyone knew that.
Oh,
I'm sorry. We were supposed to have more microphones, but we only have this one. So stand up and come up here in a single file line if you want to ask questions.
I heard there was extra credit for asking a question, so come get your extra point.
So the Palm 1100 men attending group. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give the first person a question. I will be back in a second or two, but I would like for the questions to, or statements to be very brief. And I believe the speakers have done a really good job of telling us a lot with a few words. I really commend that. And
you're the first person to accuse me of that ever.
That's a good thing, though. You know, we have a saying in communication, I don't know who said it, but the speech in order to be immortal does not have to be eternal. And I think that you all would appreciate that and have said a lot of good things during the hour. Now, the way we're going to proceed is ask your questions succinctly, and then we're going to just pass the mic to the next person. If you go a little bit too long, I'm going to give you the proverbial hook. So identify yourself as the first speaker, and I'd like everybody, if you're comfortable with it, you can introduce your name as you ask your question. Okay, and we'll go until the president calls it, and we'll just go from there. So here's our first question, and just pass the mic back.
Hello, Mark. My name is Daniel, and you mentioned in response to one of the questions about how you feel that, or the person that you were quoting thinks that Africa needs God.
Mm-hmm.
Something that was interesting that I read about a few months ago is that as a result of some of the evangelical movements in Africa, there was a law in Uganda that would make homosexuality punishable by death. Do you think that is part of God's effect, that is the kind of effect that God should be having in Africa?
Yeah, that's a good question. And the whole issue of homosexuality is something that the church has handled very, very poorly and not according to God's heart, I would think, at all. In the New Testament, you've got the story of the Jewish leaders bringing a woman that was caught in adultery, someone that had broken the moral code, and the people were gathered around her ready to stone her, which was what they were supposed to do. And yet Jesus redefines the moral code. He says, the person that doesn't have any sin, go ahead and cast that first stone. And of course, nobody does, because everybody has sin. And they gradually move away, and Jesus doesn't condemn the woman. As a matter of fact, tradition says that it's that woman that later, before Jesus' crucifixion, washed his feet with her tears and poured really expensive perfume on his feet, showing her affection for him. It's that kind of love that should be the hallmark of a Christian, not the kind of persecution we're talking about there. Early Christians were known by their love. They were called little Christians, means little Christ. As followers of Christ, those are kind of patterns that we should be following. So, yeah. Sure.
Real quick before we get to the next question, I want to remind people that there's the donation thing up for an actual charity that's going to benefit. And remind me when we're done, Mark, because I have a follow-up question to you on that, but I don't want to take up everybody's time.
Sure.
Just curiosity.
Yeah.
Okay, my question's for Mark. I have a lot of questions I'd like to ask you, but I'll only ask one. It's simple. I live a finite life. I may not be perfect. I might do wrong now and then. But still, my crime is finite. So how does that justify infinite punishment?
Christianity is all about relationship. It's a relationship with God. That's what if you could capture in a nutshell what the Bible is saying, Isaiah and Jeremiah both say it. It's God saying to us, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you by name, and you are mine. It's all about relationship. All the laws and everything that are in there are all designed to show God's people what it means to be pure and holy, to be able to be in a relationship with him. I'm trying to remember who it was that said that, a lot of people think that, well, if I put things on the scales and my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, I'm good. In God's perspective, though, one good deed automatically, he expects all good deeds because he's a holy God. And one bad deed tips the whole scale forever. You can't do enough good, you can't do any good to take back the expected goodness out of us. And don't get it wrong. I mean, I'm telling you that the Bible is all about God wanting to have a relationship with us. Think about it. God created you. God created you knowing that he was going to die for you. And he loves you that much that he created you anyway. And so his passion for you is immense. And you're not going to hell if you pursue God. God says, if you seek me, you'll find me. If you seek me with all your heart. So your story's not over. And so I guess that'd be my answer.
Sure.
Sorry, I just have some fantastic news. Someone in this room is willing to match all the donations up to $500. So. We would love to have more than $1,000, but $1,000 is how much money we need to send the supplies that we've collected to Uganda. If we can get as much money from you guys as we can ship that stuff tomorrow.
Hi, this is for Mark. In the Bible, there are several mentions of things that God has ordained, such as genocide, stoning. You can purchase slaves. You can beat your slaves to death. And I don't think any of us in this room think that those things are by any means okay. So where does that outside morality? It seems that with you and me and everyone here are more moral than the God that has ordained all these things. So where do those outside morals come from?
That's an awesome question. I think my favorite passage in the Old Testament is one that says, if two guys are fighting and one of their wives grabs the, is it wife? Or,
yeah,
you know,
two are struggling and she strikes one of them in his
private parts, then her hand's supposed to be cut off, which probably says more about the wrath of Jewish women than the wrath of God. But I don't know, maybe that's, I shouldn't say that. But my wife's Italian, and that's the wrath for a month. I'm glad you brought up that question. As I was saying before, I wanted to expand on it, and this gives me that opportunity. God's taking a bunch of slaves, people that had been slaves for 400 years, didn't know anything about morality except what they heard from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he's got to teach them what morality is. He's got to bring them out of a polytheistic culture into another land filled with polytheists. And to do that, he gives them a code. Now, let me say this first, real quickly, hopefully. I was teaching one time in a computer setting. I taught software stuff. And after the class, one of the guys came up to me and asked me if I was a Christian. And I don't know how he knew, because maybe I didn't cuss that much or something. But so I said, yeah, sure. And he was all excited, because he was a Christian too, just got saved recently. And he said to me, God's been doing this amazing stuff in my life. He said, I used to sleep around all the time, and now I'm just sleeping with my girlfriend. And so if you're a Christian, you're probably going to chuckle. If you're not, then it's like, well, yeah. For a Christian, that's a process of sanctification, and it's God working in us, making us more like Christ, which is the process that all Christians should be engaged in, right? And one of the things I want to point out is that Christians are definitely not necessarily better than atheists, but a Christian should be a better person than he would have been not as a Christian, as he follows the teachings of Christ and proceeds in that direction. So the process of sanctification is going on in this guy's life, which is for Christian becoming more like Christ. The same thing happens in cultures as well. And so God was taking his people out of this this secular culture, bringing, and by the way,
the people around them were much worse than any of the commands that God gave them. So Assyrians would do things like stake you to the ground and strip the skin off of you and leave you that way. But at the very least, it was a violent time, and judging them by our standards is difficult. But if you judge them by the standards of the day, God was elevating their morality. He was giving protection to women that didn't have protections before, and to slaves. But then you come to the New Testament, new standards are being given that are, so, you know, in the Old Testament, you know, if you had a slave, there was a penalty for hurting them. In the New Testament, you're still allowed to have slaves, but a slave has to be your brother. You treat them like a brother. And if you treat a slave like a brother in a culture where slaves are allowed, that slave's not going to be a slave anymore. And then you advance to our current day, and those ethics have been redefined even more.
This question's for Matt.
Yay.
I was going to be for Mark, but I decided instead of grilling you about
thanks.
That, I don't get mad.
Let the guy drink it. By the way, is there water for him or something? Because I finished my tea, and I know she's been up here, I didn't drink anything.
Matt, the answer that we just got sounded similar to the same argument that you brought up at the very beginning about cultures determining what's good and bad. It doesn't seem like any culture would be justified to listen to the voice in your head that tells you to bind up your son and sacrifice him like Abraham is supposed to do. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, actually, there's a number of things in here, you know. There's the kind of standard apologetics answers that we get to these objectionable passages in the Bible, and one of them that Mark offered was that, well, these people were much, much worse than what God actually did to them. Well, who cares? We're talking about God's character, not the character of the people. But when you're talking, the question addressed things like slavery. Well, did slavery used to be morally okay, and then it changed? There's a command to kill the homosexuals, and did that change? I mean, did it used to be moral once upon a time to kill homosexuals? And if it did, then morality has changed, and the idea of a God-driven, unchanging moral system is simply wrong. What tends to happen, what, for example, Ray Comfort has said, is that he doesn't believe everything the Bible's true. So those Jews just got all that stuff wrong, which means that for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, even if you're a 6,000 young earther, or perhaps longer, God didn't seem to care too much about making sure that people didn't know that you shouldn't own another human being as property. And by the way, that's never corrected. There may be admonitions about treating them nicer, but if you go to 2 Peter 2:18, it specifically says, slaves, obey your masters, even the cruel ones. I'm sorry, but the only correct thing you should say to a slave is get out. And if your master is particularly cruel, get out now and take everybody with you. That is not the word of a wise being at all. So this idea that morality somehow changed, I think, is a pitfall to the whole Christian kind of paradigm there. And I don't know if that answered your question because you took off. Yeah, okay.
Questions I'd like to ask you, but I'll only ask one. It's simple. I live a finite life. I may not be perfect. I might do wrong now and then. But still, my crime is finite. So how does that justify infinite punishment?
Christianity is all about relationship. It's a relationship with God. That's what if you can capture in a nutshell what the Bible is saying, Isaiah and Jeremiah both say it, it's God saying to us, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you by name, and you are mine. It's all about relationship. All the laws and everything that are in there are all designed to show God's people what it means to be pure and holy, to be able to be in relationship with him. I'm trying to remember who it was that said that, a lot of people think that, well, if I put things on the scales and my good deeds outweigh my bad deeds, I'm good. In God's perspective, though, you know, one good deed automatically, he expects all good deeds, because he's a holy God, and one bad deed tips the whole scale forever. You can't do enough good, you can't do any good to take back the expected goodness out of us. And don't get it wrong. I mean, I'm telling you that the Bible is all about God wanting to have a relationship with us. Think about it. God
created you, God created you knowing that he was going to die for you. And he loves you that much that he created you anyway. And so his passion for you is immense. And you're not going to hell if you pursue God. God says, if you seek me, you'll find him. If you seek me with all your heart. So your story's not over. So I guess that'd be my answer.
Sure.
Sorry, I just have some fantastic news. Someone in this room is willing to match all the donations up to $500. So. We would love to have more than $1,000, but $1,000 is how much money we need to send the supplies that we've collected to Uganda. If we can get as much money from you guys as we can ship that stuff tomorrow.
Hi, this is from Mark.
In the Bible, there are several mentions of things that God has ordained, such as genocide, stoning. You can purchase slaves. You can beat your slaves to death. And I don't think any of us in this room think that those things are by any means okay. So where does that outside morality? It seems that with you and me and everyone here are more moral than the God that has ordained all these things. So where do those outside morals come from?
That's an awesome question. I think my favorite passage in the Old Testament is one that says, if two guys are fighting and one of their wives grabs the,
and she strikes one of them in his
private parts, then her hand's supposed to be cut off, which probably says more about the wrath of Jewish women than the wrath of God. But I don't know. Maybe that's, I shouldn't say that. But my wife's Italian. That's the wrath of God. I'm glad you brought up that question. What's happened? As I was saying before, I wanted to expand on it, and this gives me that opportunity. God's taking a bunch of slaves, people that had been slaves for 400 years, didn't know anything about morality except what they heard from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he's got to teach them what morality is. He's got to bring them out of a polytheistic culture into another land filled with polytheists, And to do that, he gives them a code. Now, let me say this first, real quickly, hopefully. I was teaching one time in a CompUSA setting. I taught software stuff. And after the class, one of the guys came up to me and asked me if I was a Christian. And I don't know how he knew, because maybe I didn't cuss that much or something. So I said, yeah, sure. And he was all excited, because he was a Christian too, just got saved recently. And he said to me, God's been doing this amazing stuff in my life. He said, I used to sleep around all the time, and now I'm just sleeping with my girlfriend. So if you're a Christian, you're probably going to chuckle. If you're not, then it's like, well, yeah. But for a Christian, that's a process of sanctification, and it's God working in us, making us more like Christ, which is the process that all Christians should be engaged in, right? And one of the things I want to point out is that Christians are definitely not necessarily better than atheists. But a Christian should be a better person than he would have been not as a Christian, as he follows the teachings of Christ and proceeds in that direction. So the process of sanctification is going on in this guy's life, which is for a Christian becoming more like Christ. The same thing happens in cultures as well. And so God was taking his people out of this this secular culture, the people around them were much worse than any of the commands that God gave them. So Assyrians would do things like stake you to the ground and strip the skin off of you and leave you that way. But at the very least, it was a violent time. And judging them by our standards
It's difficult. If you judge them by the standards of the day, God was elevating their morality. He was giving protection to women that didn't have protections before, and to slaves. But then you come to the New Testament, new standard. You know, it damages our spirit to do something like that. And what damages our spirit damages our relationships, especially with our wives and with God. I've got there's a song here that I have some lyrics to that I thought were interesting and probably appropriate for this time of season, and maybe articulate this idea a little bit better than I could. It's by a folk singer named Alan Levi, and it's called Santa and Victoria. Let me see if I can read it in my next 1 minute that I have left. You guys are going to like this, whether you agree with it or not. So. This year they put Santa in the Montgomery Mall, right next to Victoria's Secret. A line stretched forever of children so small next to Victoria's Secret. A strange contradiction, but somehow not quite, both of them wearing their best red and white, selling the promise of endless delight next to Victoria's Secret. The children were glued to that old, kind old Saint Nick next to Victoria's Secret, while the grown-ups were glued to the curves of Saint Vic next to Victoria's Secret. The kids had their lists for the man in the sleigh, while the mannequins stood there in fine lingerie, both making a promise that neither could pay. That is Victoria's Secret. Now the pleasures they offer are perfectly good, but they can't fill our hearts like we wish that they would. They know how to fool me, Victoria and Nick, to dress up your dream, Nick, make it glossy and slick, and I'm all too eager to fall for the trick next to Victoria's Secret. So there's from the Christian perspective, all the sex and all the money and all the stuff in the world can't fill the empty void that's in our hearts that only God can fill.
Okay, thank you very much. I will now move on to the next question. We'll start with Mark Allison on this one and then go to Matt Dillahunty. Helping developing nations is a key goal for many secular nonprofits and church groups alike. These groups often find themselves struggling with limited resources. Secular groups spend their resources on teaching people to read, write, understand math, and sustainable living techniques, while churches spend what resources they have on building churches and teaching the Bible. Which type of organization is doing more good for the community and why?
First of all, I don't really agree with the premise of this question, and I got some statistics to back it up. So in 2001, 35% of the total of all U.S. Protestant agencies was spent towards secular relief work. In 2005, that went up to 46% of all their money. And in 2008, it went down a little bit to 44%. So just want to point out that it's not like all the money is going to building churches. And there is certainly in Africa, especially, a long tradition of secular support by building hospitals, schools. You see that all over, in addition to churches, because as as Christians, we believe, as I mentioned before, that we're not just body, we're spirit too, and we need to minister to the needs of both of those. I was looking in the Times newspaper, the London Times, and found an article by one of their writers, Matthew Paris, and I want to just share a little bit of that. It's titled, "As an Atheist, I Truly Believe Africa Needs God." Just share a little bit of that with you. Before Christmas, I returned after 45 years to the country that as a boy I knew as Nyasaland. Today it's Malawi, and the Times Christmas appeal includes a small British charity working there. Pump Aid helps rural communities to install a simple pump, letting people keep their village well sealed and clean, and I went to see this work. It inspired me, renewing my flagging faith in development charities, but traveling in Malawi refreshed another belief too, one that I've been trying to banish all my life. But an observation I've been unable to avoid since my African childhood. It confounds my ideological beliefs, stubbornly refuses to fit my worldview, and has embarrassed my growing belief that there's no God. Now a confirmed atheist, I become convinced of the enormous contribution that Christian evangelism makes in Africa, sharply distinct from the work of secular NGOs, government projects, and international aid efforts. This alone will not do. These alone will not do. Education and training alone will not do. In Africa, Christianity changes people's hearts. It brings a spiritual transformation. The rebirth is real, and the change is good. I used to avoid this truth by applauding, as you can, the practical work of mission churches in Africa. It's a pity, I would say, that salvation is part of the package,
But Christians, black and white, working in Africa, do heal the sick, do teach people to read and write, and only the severest kind of secularist could see a mission hospital or school and say the world would be better without it. I would allow that if faith was needed to motivate missionaries to help, then fine, but what counted was the help, not the faith. But this doesn't fit the facts. Faith does more than support the missionary. It is also transferred to his flock. This is the effect that matters so immensely, which I cannot help observing. And he goes on to mention how changes in the African people themselves was noticeable, especially around areas where mission influence was the greatest.
Okay, thank you very much. And a 3-minute rejoinder.
Yeah, I'm glad you found a quote from an atheist. It always bugs me when atheists start talking about spiritual transformations, but I can identify them in the same way that you could identify a Catholic speaking. They're not particularly skeptical or critical thinkers. The claim that not all the money goes to churches, great. And Christians do great things, great works around the world, all lots of religions do. The question was, which was better? And if I have $100 to spend on aid, is it better that $100 goes to the people who need it or that $90 go to the people who need it and we put 10 towards the church because we believe that people are body and spirit? Well, it's great that you believe that body, actually I won't say it's great because I would prefer that people didn't believe that unless it can be demonstrated to be true. And truth is what I actually care about. Whether or not something's true is the only thing that I really care about when we're talking about intellectual matters like that. That doesn't mean that atheists are Vulcans or robots or don't have thoughts about a poetic human spirit or lifting us as groups and as individuals. But religious groups have had preferential treatment for a very long time, which makes them efficient charities to donate to, or easier to donate to those charities. And they have access to things that other groups don't necessarily have. But you do have secular charity organizations like SHARE and like Foundation Beyond Belief, and these people go out and do work without the baggage. It reminds me, downtown in Austin, on the 6th Street overpass, or just underneath it, every Sunday morning there's a church service that takes place there, and they hand out food to the homeless. And it always struck me as odd that you wanted to hold a sandwich hostage until you could preach to them. And I understand, don't get me wrong, I was a Christian for 25 years, I understand that from the Christian perspective, this is important, this is true. But to outsiders, it's not important and it's not true. And before we should actually allow people to impose that view on them, we should require that people demonstrate that their beliefs are actually true. You have to view it from the outside as we need to be convinced that what you're saying has any value or any meaning because I'm just here to get a sandwich. And so there's an atheist group that goes down there, Atheists Helping the Homeless, that hands out food. The number one question we get asked, what church are you from? We're not from any church. We're just handing it out because you needed food. That's it.
Next question, first to Matt. Dillahunty, a little bit shorter one. What do you think about stem cell research?
I think it's essential. I don't even know that there's really a serious moral question here. I know there seems to be for some people. For me, it's fairly straightforward that opposing stem cell research is flatly immoral. You're costing people's lives and preventing cures because of a collection of cells that, while some people might think that their God has blessed and instilled with a soul, it doesn't even appear in any way to be human outside of DNA. So you've got a collection of cells that, yes, they're living, but in most cases, these stem cells that we're using are cast off from things like fertilization and stuff. And these things would be going to waste anyway. But my take on this is that if it is, in fact, immoral, we have to show that. We cannot simply assert it as a matter of religious conviction. We live in a secular country governed by a secular constitution, despite what many apologists will say. God was voted out every time during the Constitutional Congress that there was an attempt to vote him in. We have the First Amendment. We have a plurality, a diverse population with a variety of different views, and you don't get to legislate your particular religious opinions on minority just because you have the power of majority. We don't have a simple majority in the United States. And it comes down to, if you
don't like it, don't do it, I guess. But when you start denying people access to medical treatments and cures simply because you have a different view of things that you cannot actually demonstrate, no matter how strongly you believe it, I would say, you know, you've stepped beyond the limits of what you should be allowed to do on the basis of your religion.
Thank you very much. And your rejoinder.
This is a difficult question, and I'm not exactly sure what the answer is. I know what the theistic view is on life. The Bible makes it pretty clear that that even in the womb, you're an actual person. You're not. It's not that you become a person the instant the umbilical cord is cut, but you are a person inside the womb. Exactly when that happens, the Bible isn't necessarily a science book, and so it doesn't really articulate that. But the problem is here that within a theistic Christian worldview, the human soul, the human life, is so valuable that any attempt to kill it yourself, to kill other human lives, is seen as a moral wrong, as a sin. And because of this, Christians also oppose things like euthanasia. Suicide is considered wrong, killing yourself. Even you would think, well, it's myself. Why can't I do what I want to do with myself? Within the Christian perspective, you're created in the image of God. God created you for a purpose, and you are a special thing because you're made in the image of God, and you don't have that right to destroy yourself or something else that also is a human life. And so so in this kind of situation, it's a tough call. But I do just want to present that theistic point of view, that a human life is considered a life even when it's a few cells, from the instant that it's fertilized. In the theistic perspective, that is a human life. And to kill a human life to make another human life more healthy is considered a moral wrong within a theistic perspective.
And here's the question, it's a little bit longer this time. Jeffrey Dahmer, known serial killer, drugged, raped, beat, murdered, performed sex acts on dead bodies, dismembered and ate 17-year-old men, yet while in jail claimed to have been saved. Helen Keller, on the other hand, dedicated her life to helping those in need. She was on the front lines of fighting for both women's rights and equal rights for the races. She is a well-known author and fought for the rights of the disabled all the way up till the time that she died. Helen Keller was an atheist. According to Christianity, Jeffrey Dahmer is enjoying the good life in heaven while Helen Keller is in the pit of eternal flame. How can you explain how this is good?
It's totally not fair.
I agree.
Go ahead. Let's make this clear. From a naturalist perspective, both those individuals, when they died, when their light switch was flipped off, faced no consequences for their actions. All right? So certainly from an atheist perspective, there is no ultimate justice for what either of those individuals did. From a Christian perspective, there's always the chance of redemption and hope, no matter what you've done. I look at God as the God of the crossroads. And whenever you get to a particular point in your life where there's a decision to make, God's there saying, will you follow me, or do you want to go your own way? And so we go our own way or whatever. But at the next juncture, the next decision point, the next crossroads, God's there again saying, how about now? You can follow me, go with me. So we always have that option for redemption in the Christian worldview. Every Christmas, for the past, since my kids were small, we've gone to a friend's house and had Scrooge night, we call it. And we all get together and obviously watch A Christmas Carol. And we all love the story. I mean, Scrooge is an amazing tale of redemption. I always cry every single time. But then I cry about anything my kids are telling. But within the Christian worldview, that's what it's all about, is that opportunity for redemption, no matter what you've done, you get to that point in your life where you tell God, it's like, I'm sorry, forgive me for what I've done, and you accept what Christ has done on the cross for you, and And as a result, you can have that that transformed life and eternal life.
Okay, thank you very much. And I now will have a rejoin up to 3 minutes.
Sure, there's this challenge against the naturalistic worldview that there's no ultimate consequences, that and you know, by my worldview, when you're dead, and so both of those individuals don't have any ultimate consequences. It's kind of the point. This is the one and only life that I'm going to get, as far as I can tell. Even if it's not, I won't find out till afterwards. But I should live it as if it's the one and only life I get, which means treating people right the first time. And means that we need to work harder to make sure that people are held accountable for their actions here and now. That we don't have this fantasy that, oh, I really should have made up with that before he died, but I'll get to do it again in another life. I don't see that you're going to, but wouldn't you have rather have done it now? Wouldn't you rather have a justice system that actually dispenses actual justice? This idea that there's no permanent, eternal, transcendent consequences for people is a big old red herring. And it's ironic that it can be mentioned while talking about a system that is nothing but a loophole. Mercy is a suspension of justice. It is not justice. It is clear in the Gospels that none of us are deserving of this, that those who get to go to heaven get there by grace. It is a suspension of justice because you all deserve hell. Not only do I think that doctrine is perverse, but it doesn't merit justice. And so to say my system doesn't have any justice, but your system doesn't have any ultimate justice, is nonsense, because your system has people who, if there were justice, would potentially deserve to burn alive. That's extreme and silly. Enjoying the good life, and while others who have lived a good life, and who, I don't know why you couldn't just leave them dead in the first place, and there are nihilists and others who discount this idea of literal hell. I don't know which position you have, and I don't want to put words in your mouth. I'm just speaking generally about the subject. If this is the one and only life I get, then it's best that I treat people right the first time, because I might not get a second chance. I could leave out of here and get hit by a bus. And I can't count the number of preachers who said, you could get hit by a bus tonight, are you sure you're right with God? I don't care. If I get hit by a bus tonight, I want to be right with the people that I love, the people who are real, the people who I know exist. So this idea that there's not eternal consequences with a naturalist position is not in any way a negative about natural.
And the next question will go to Matt Dillahunty first. You have invited your teenage daughter's boyfriend over for dinner.
No, I haven't.
Maybe she invited him. You walk into the living room to tell them dinner's ready. You find them sitting a little closer to each other than you're comfortable with. Dinner goes well and the boyfriend goes home. What kind of conversation will you have with your daughter that night?
The first conversation, this has to do a little bit, I guess. I don't know that I'll necessarily ever be in this situation. The first conversation, I would have expected my daughter to understand what I wasn't comfortable with in my home. And this would then be a violation of the rules. Maybe have a little conversation to remind her about where the boundaries are. And then, make sure we're clear and honest and talk to each other. And if she's not understanding what I mean by boundaries, I'll be happy to talk to her boyfriend. The other thing is that there's this idea of personal responsibility is huge in secular moral systems. I spoke a little bit earlier about boundaries and putting people into boxes. The idea that we live in a vacuum is nonsense. Every one of my actions impacts everybody around me. And so teaching your kids honesty, teaching your kids self-respect, teaching your kids about boundaries, teaching your kids about personal responsibility is one of the best things you can do. Now, I just got married 2 weeks ago, so I don't actually, I guess that doesn't follow that I wouldn't have kids. I could have had kids anyway. But I don't actually have kids yet, though I will in the future if everything goes as planned. And I don't know what I'm going to do when it comes to raising kids. I plan to screw it up just like everybody else I've ever met. But I'm going to do my best to screw it up less than some people have perhaps done it. And I would like to think that by the time I had a teenage daughter with a boy over, that maybe this issue wouldn't be around, or that maybe it wouldn't be as big a deal. But I know that whatever kid that I have, I'm going to be able to talk to them. They will be educated
on the scientific facts. They will be able to protect themselves. They will understand their responsibility. They will know that they are an independent person who has the right to say no in a heartbeat, no matter what. And that if they are ready and responsible that and willing to take responsibility for the action, that they have the right to say yes. I'm not a tyrant. Granted, there will be certain things I won't allow in the house, you know, because you're comfortable with what you're comfortable with. But I think that a lot of these problems just don't exist. Maybe I'm naive because I don't have kids yet. If you actually raise kids in an honest environment where they are comfortable coming to you with anything.
Thank you very much, and now you're rejoined.
I think I'd like to have Matt come and talk to my kids, at least when they were younger. He sounds good. But I think after I showed the boyfriend my gun cabinet, and we had a long talk. Just kidding, it'd be a short talk. I've got two teenage daughters and one that's just out of the teen years, so I've had some experience with this already, and so if I can give any help.
I might call you later.
I totally agree with Matt. These kind of things should be obviously discussed before boyfriends come over, and hopefully you have an atmosphere that encourages open discussion with your children and these kind of topics. When the boyfriend's there and they're sitting next to each other, it's not the time to start discussing them. Although my best friend David that I mentioned, on his wedding day, his father gave him a book from the 1800s on sex. And on his wedding day, I thought that was a little, I guess it was the time, but it was about a 300-page book, so I had a lot of reading to do before the night came. But standards are being given that are, so, in the Old Testament, if you had a slave, there was a penalty for hurting them. In the New Testament, you're still allowed to have slaves, but a slave has to be your brother. You treat them like a brother. And if you treat a slave like a brother in a culture where slaves are allowed, that slave's not going to be a slave anymore. And then you advance to our current day, and those ethics have been redefined even more.
This question's for Matt.
Yay!
I was going to be for Mark, but I decided instead of grilling you about
thanks.
That, I don't get mad.
Right. Let the guy drink it. By the way, is there water for him or something? Because I finished my tea and I know she's not great at drinking.
Matt, the answer that we just got sounded similar to the same argument that you brought up at the very beginning about cultures determining what's good and bad. It doesn't seem like any culture would be justified to listen to the voice in your head that tells you to bind up your son and sacrifice him like Abraham was supposed to do. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, actually, there's a number of things in here, there's the kind of standard apologetics answers that we get to these objectionable passages in the Bible, and one of them that Mark offered was that, well, these people were much, much worse than what God actually did to them. Well, who cares? We're talking about God's character, not the character of the people. But when you're talking, the question addressed things like slavery. Well, did slavery used to be morally okay, and then it changed? There's a command to kill the homosexuals, and did that change? I mean, did it used to be moral once upon a time to kill homosexuals? And if it did, then morality has changed, and the idea of a God-driven, unchanging moral system is simply wrong. What tends to happen, for example, Ray Comfort has said, is that he doesn't believe everything the Bible's true. So those Jews just got all that stuff wrong, which means that for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, even if you're a 6,000 young earther, or perhaps longer, God didn't seem to care too much about making sure that people didn't know that you shouldn't own another human being as property. And by the way, that's never corrected. There may be admonitions about treating them nicer, but if you go to 2 Peter 2:18, it specifically says, slaves, obey your masters, even the cruel ones. I'm sorry, but the only correct thing you should say to a slave is get out. And if your master is particularly cruel, get out now and take everybody with you. That is not the word of a wise being at all. So this idea that morality somehow changed, I think, is a pitfall to the whole Christian kind of paradigm there. And I don't know if that answered your question because you took off. Yeah, okay.
And I had something else I was going to add to that, but I forgot it while I was preaching.
Hi. First thing I want to say is thank both of you for coming here and doing this debate. I know this is really well. But my question was for both of you. So we've kind of talked around this subject, but I was kind of curious, just to pinpoint, do either of you think that the driving force behind the morality we have today is primarily based on Christian morals or secular morals?
I'll just go quickly. I think that Friedrich Nietzsche said something like, it's not enough that that God needs to be out of the picture. The shadow of God needs to be out of the picture as well. And I think the shadow of God is still in the picture in Europe and certainly here in the United States. And I think Matt's talked a lot about morality, and it's good. But those kind of morals are the consequences of cultures that have been steeped in Judeo-Christian tradition for 2,000 years. And those kind of things don't dissipate quickly. When they do dissipate, then we'll see the true result of living in a, if they do dissipate, they will see the true result of living in a materialist-based society.
Yeah, and actually, I've never agreed with you more on that, except for a couple of good jokes. But the thing is, I think the dirty little secret is Luther changed the way Christianity works by giving people this ability, well, Paul did, but Luther made it a reality that people could have this personal relationship. It means everybody gets their own interpretation, and nobody's God told me is any more powerful than anybody else's God told me. And I think the dirty little secret is that Christianity and Judaism have been dragged somewhat kicking and screaming through some rather nasty times by an enlightenment, by secular progressive ideas and values. It's not like God came down one day and wrote a Bible 2.0, and yes, I know it's not one book. I'm shortening it by making a long explanation. It's not like God came down and gave a Bible 2.0 that said, oh yeah, that stuff about slavery, I don't know who you were talking about, but I didn't say that. Slavery's wrong. Oh yeah, that stuff about women, I don't know who you were talking about, but that wasn't me. There was no correction. This idea of equality and this idea of a secular government that we have in the United States, these are Enlightenment principles that came from primarily seculars. Now, many of them were, you know, deists, which I think are kind of the equivalent of atheists of their day to some degree. But yeah, I think it's secular values that have been pushing this, and I think that perhaps in 1,000 years you might see an Islam that has been moved forward across the board by these same secular progressives, hopefully working alongside modern liberal theists of other beliefs to bring the world to a better place, because I don't have any delusions that we're going to get rid of religion. And by the way, I don't have it as a goal. My goal is truth. If it turns out religion's true, I want to know. That's how I got started in all this in the first place.
Okay, first, thank you for hosting this interview. And my question is, for example, like, drug is really moral to hippie, and then alcohol is really moral to alcoholism, like who have alcoholism. And can you tell me what's your perfect moral world?
Perfect moral world? Well, you know, the Bible articulates what a perfect moral world would be, and that day will come when there's no sickness, disease, evil, slavery, things like that. And I don't think alcohol has anything to do with it. Jesus made it. I wish I could do that. but yeah, the Bible articulates what that perfect world would be. And, it said, according to a theistic worldview, that God created the world. The world fell in the same sin that Adam and Eve fell in, and so the earth itself is warped a little bit. And one day that'll all change. The earth will be renovated. People will be probably living in the same kind of world that Matt hopes we'll all live in one day too?
Yeah, I mean, there may be some slight differences. You know, twice you talked about God creating the world. Once you mentioned that God created knowing that he would have to die as a sacrifice, etc. And that there is the perfect world coming. And my answer is, my question is, has always been, if God created the world knowing all this is going to happen, why not create the perfect world at the beginning and skip all of this bloodshed and travesty in the middle? Skip right to the end of the book if you already know it, rather than putting the people through it. It's a really frustratingly difficult question. My utopia, my moral utopia, it doesn't exist. I'm not advocating, I don't think we'll ever get to perfection. I just think perfection should be the goal so that we continue moving forward to getting better. And the reason that I'm a huge proponent of secular humanism and secular value systems is that they have within them the capability to change. They are internally driven. We are the participants. We are the architects. We have a say in this process. And change comes in a secular system by discussion and debate and becoming convinced. And in the religious conflicts from the various religious proposals about morals, change comes from struggle and conversion more than becoming convinced. And there are people certainly who become convinced that their particular religion is true. I don't want to diminish it. But secularism has that as its foundation, that this is the way we should change. The question that I would love to actually maybe sit down at some point and talk to Mark about is, okay, you and I have different worldviews, we have different ideas about morality, we have all these, how do we resolve those? How do the two of us sit down and determine what's actually true? And to the extent that we might not be able to, how do we sit down and determine what kind of world we're willing to share and maintain our boundaries? That's the kind of question that I'm actually interested in. Is there an answer? I don't know.
Hi. My question's for Matt.
Mm-hmm.
In reference to your statement that there is no actual justice in the plan of mercy by God granting us grace and, you know, forgiving us of all of our wrongdoings and sins, I think that's just sort of a comment before my question. I think that's sort of ignoring the idea of, you know, the core of Christianity, which is that Jesus Christ actually came and took that punishment that we deserve. And so I guess my question is, do you believe that the punishment that Christ took for us is in fact just in itself? Because I didn't hear you mention that in the comments, that there is no you know, ultimate justice in God's plan. So I guess just my question is, do you believe that Christ, if, you know, of course, speaking or saying that this, that Christianity is real and that Jesus did exist and that God does exist, do you believe that it would be hypothetically a just thing to do to punish his own son for the wrongs that we did and then granting us mercy in return?
No. And if I take that as a hypothetical, I'll do my best to take it as hypothetical. The problem is that, and I used to see things that way. I used to see, for example, the story of Abraham and Isaac in a way very different from than I see now, and I may get to that later. But when I look at this, even if I try to take it as a hypothetical, it's so absurd and patently offensive. The idea, first of all, of original sin is immoral. The idea of substitutionary atonement is immoral. If I owe somebody something and somebody else comes along and pays them, yeah, that gets me off the hook. But if I've wronged somebody, which is what we're talking about when we're talking about moral things and not just a $20 bill, say somebody else telling them that I'm sorry doesn't do a thing. So I'm opposed to the idea of original sin, opposed to the concept of sin entirely, the idea that butts are crimes or that you've wronged some being. I don't know how you can wrong a God. It seems silly to me. But substitutionary atonement is also something that I think is immoral. And the part of it that I find absurd is that you have this all-knowing, all-loving being who creates a system, supposedly or reportedly by some, knowing what's going to happen, and he's the architect of the rules of this system, I would think, by everything I ever learned. And so you have a God that created a system knowing that he would actually have to take human form and come down and sacrifice himself to himself to serve as a loophole for a rule that he created. It's as absurd as why don't we skip to the end of the book? Why not just forgive him?
Okay, I have a question to both of you. I would like to kind of touch on the subject of Bible, the source of morality. You know, when I look at the story of Jewish people leaving Egypt, arriving at the promised land, and they are supposed to live there happily ever after, but there is a problem, somebody is already living there. And then the Lord gives them direct order to go and kill everybody, including children, women, everybody. Now the question is, when they did, right? They went and they killed everybody. Was this act of killing everybody a moral act, or was this an immoral act? That's kind of a direct question.
I'll go first, it was immoral.
Staying with my premise that the God was taking a group of people from out of a situation where they didn't know anything about him, bringing them to a place eventually where they would, where we are now. That was a process. So just as you are watching your kids learning how to take their first steps, you don't criticize them because they can't run a marathon. In the same way, as God deals with cultures, he takes the culture from where they are, baby steps, brings them to eventually where they'll be here, and where we abhor things like slavery, and which, by the way, and at least you know, in England, certainly was spearheaded by Christians.
Yes.
This is a question for Mark. Recently, there was a law on the ballot in Mississippi that would have declared personhood at conception and would have effectively outlawed most birth control, like IUDs and the pill. You kind of touched on the subject with the stem cells, but how do you feel about the idea of life and contraception in relation to birth control and women's rights?
First of all, I'd say that that the Bible has always elevated women above the level of their surrounding culture, whenever that happened to be. Okay? Yes. The Bible's always, the Bible elevated them above where they are now. But until, in regard to what I said with stem cell research, life happens at conception according to the theistic worldview, so you're killing a life if you do that, and that's why we oppose that. Go ahead, you can respond.
On the idea of the Bible elevating women, I wish we'd had a debate on that, actually, because there's so much, and I think that I'll just use the go-to quickest one, which is, if you rape a woman, you have to marry her. Women were property. You had spoiled some other man's property, and your penalty for raping a woman was to marry her and pay 15 shekels, which I think we can adjust for inflation. That, in the same way that I mentioned this problem about Abraham and Isaac, first of all, you don't hear too much about how it felt to be Isaac or what kind of torture it was to be in a position where your father's going to kill you, but speaking of what I'm talking about, there's absolutely no consideration at all of whether or not a woman who's been raped wants to be forced to live and marry the person who raped her. That is an absurd thing that does nothing to elevate women. The idea of, when we talk about potential abortion positions and things, the Bible is relatively silent on abortion. Jeremiah 1:5 is a go-to verse where it says, I knew you before I crafted you in the womb, which to me is a testimony of God talking about, I knew you were soul before even any conception occurred, and not anything about in the womb. Jewish law doesn't consider a fetus in the womb to be a person. When the censuses were taken in the Bible, it wasn't until the child had been alive for a month, because infant mortality rates were incredible at the time. And there's a passage about a man struggling, and a woman is forced to miscarry. There's a different penalty for the miscarriage of a child than there is for the intentional killing of the woman. So the fetus isn't considered a person in the Bible in any sense. It's a matter of interpretation that people feel that way about it, because God kind of knew you in the womb, so you must be a person.
And I don't see anything that particularly elevates women in Christianity. I just find it baffling that everything you said tonight, I've seen where it was coming from, and a lot of it, I put my hat on from back when I was a Southern Baptist. But not that one. I don't have to save it for whatever.
When are we going out afterwards?
When you guys ever do
these
examples, I had a conversation,
so
you do that, I'm sure everyone
would be. Maybe I'll do a Skype nonprofits with Mark at some point. We'll have all the conversations.
On that previous topic, just because you said earlier that the child or fetus or a life was actually once egg was fertilized, however, contraceptives would only be preventing an egg from being fertilized, not necessarily killing one that was.
Something that doesn't stops that process from a physical view wouldn't be a problem. Maybe if you're Catholic.
Yeah.
But not within Protestant evangelism.
And to revisit something else you said. You said that lust hurts our self-being. Within the context of a loving, faithful, monogamous relationship, if those two individuals were to watch, say, pornography before sexual intercourse, how would that be degrading to an individual's self?
Because you're a spiritual being as well as a physical being, things that can affect your spirit affect you. And within the Christian worldview, those kind of things do affect you, and it just makes sense. I mean, if you have an idea of what sex should be like from watching pornography, that's going to shift your view of what sex should be. And from a Christian perspective, pornography is wrong, and those kind of shifts are damaging.
I'm really sorry, what necessarily makes watching pornography make it have an effect on you? You don't feel like you could watch it and not be changed and have your own ideas, watch something and still separate your ideals from sex?
Actually, if I could jump in, I agree with it that it has an effect on you. I just don't agree that it's necessarily negative. Why would you watch it?
If nothing else, it has an effect on the people that are engaged in the pornography. And by participating and watching it, you're validating what they're doing. And we feel that that's destructive for them, whether they acknowledge that kind of effect or not. And participating in the hurt of somebody else is not something that Christians could do.
This is another one from Mark. All my Christian friends claim that they are believers because God revealed himself to them in some way. My question is, if God created us all, why does he choose to reveal himself to some, not to others?
Big clap. Thanks, Kevin. I think God has revealed himself to all. God speaks through his word, but the Christian view is that the Bible is God's word to us, and it's inspired, which means it's God-breathed, that the Holy Spirit speaks through it, and so he talks to us. So God speaks to anybody that will listen, and that's the worldview. And there's it's called a Christian faith,